Good morning and welcome to the HART regular board meeting. I call this meeting to order. Please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Okay, first part of the agenda is our new board member. Sherry Donahue, who was elected to Temple Terrace City Council, is now our new board member. She just got elected in 2014, this is the first time that I've served with you on this board, and I'm happy to welcome you. She grew up in Tampa. She graduated from Tampa Catholic High School and has lived in Temple Terrace with her husband, Mike, for 38 years. Ms. Donahue has a long history of service to the community. Among her many accolades and awards, she was named Temple Terrace's Citizen of the Year in 1990. And Best Regional Rotary Club President, Small Club Division, in 2012. She's been active in numerous organizations, notably the Temple Terrace Junior Women's Club, Temple Terrace Arts Council, American Cancer Society Relay for Life, and Girl Scouts of America. She's a past president of both the Greater Temple Terrace Chamber of Commerce and the Rotary Club of Temple Terrace. As a co-founder of the annual Art en Blanc Sunday in the Park and other events, she has raised tens of thousands of dollars for charity. Commissioner Donahue has been active in area schools, serving on the PTSA boards of several schools and serving on the boards of the University of Tampa and USF, Go Bulls, and she and her husband have 4 grown children and 9 grandchildren, so she's very busy outside of her job. Welcome, and thank you for being here. Okay, next up, Commissioner, yeah. It's good to have a vice chair because she's pointing things out to me. Commissioner Merman had a brief presentation that she wanted to make.
Yes.
If that's okay, go ahead, ma'am.
Absolutely. And if I could ask Ms. Egan to come to the podium.
It's not often that you get big awards, and she's a very humble person. She keeps them very quiet. So I wanted to commend her today in front of our board and the public and just for this recognition that she just received. And this commendation says, the Hillsborough County Board of County Commissioners is pleased to recognize Catherine Egan for her leadership in providing transportation options to the people of Hillsborough County and the Tampa Bay region. Work that earned her the Tampa Chapter of Women's Transportation Seminar Woman of the Year Award. As Chief Executive Officer of the Hillsborough Area Regional Transit Authority since 2014, and with nearly 2 decades of experience as a transportation planner, Ms. Egan has advanced transit through innovation and strategic partnerships. Under her leadership, HART continues to expand travel options beyond traditional buses and increase the number of women in senior management positions. The agency established the nation's first transit-operated rideshare service, became Florida's first transit system to receive the prestigious certification for environmental sustainability and management systems. She directed the development of a paratransit cab service pilot program that provides patrons same-day service for the first time and led the creation of a performance scorecard. She also helped create an innovative farmers market at a heavily used transit center. Prior to being named HART CEO, she was the agency's chief operating officer. Her leadership helped grow ridership and fare box recovery by more than 20%. The Board of County Commissioners of Hillsborough County, Florida, does hereby commend Catherine Egan for her achievements in advancing public transit, congratulates her on being named the Tampa Chapter Women's Transportation Seminar 2016 Woman of the Year, signed by all 7 county commissioners.
So I normally hate surprises.
I know.
But this is fantastic. Thank you so much. This is going to go into the board report where it comes to my evaluation. Small joke. Everyone at this dais has heard it before. None of the work we do is possible without, hands down, the absolute best team in public transit today. I've been saying it for 7 years. You're going to keep hearing it, hopefully, for more years in the future. Everything on this document was made possible by the team behind me. I can nag them. I set direction. I can push them forward. But they make the magic happen. thank you for this outstanding recognition, and happy New Year. Thank you so much.
All right, next up on the agenda is Mr. Smith. He's in the back coming in. Please relieve me of my duties, sir. You are here to run the election of the chair, so please move forward. Mr. Smith.
Good morning. Excuse me. Good morning, David Smith. I actually was here, as you know. I was checking with the boss, which would be Ms. Bennett. This is the time we elect the chair, the vice chair, and the secretary. As you may remember, and for those of you who haven't been here before, we have to have one county elected, one city elected, and one non-elected serve in those three positions. There, other than that, I think since Mr. Suarez is no longer eligible for chair, we certainly have an open position on chair. And what we do is we typically, our process is to take nominations from the floor. So without further ado, I'd open up the floor for nominations. Does anybody have a nomination for chair? Mr. Bowers.
Yes, I'd like to nominate Commissioner Miller for chair.
Okay, Mr. Jacob.
It wasn't me.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I was going to nominate Commissioner Miller also.
Any further nominations? Seeing no interest in further nominations, we close the nominations. We should have a vote nonetheless. All in favor of electing Mr. Miller as chair, please indicate by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Good. We now have a chair. Congratulations. The next position for which we are receiving nominations is vice chair. Do I see anyone who would like to make a nomination for vice chair? Yes, sir. Mr. Carino.
Yeah, I'd like to nominate Director Jarosz, continue in that position.
Okay. Are there any further nominations? Anyone else wish to make a nomination? Seeing yes, ma'am.
I would like to nominate, do we have to nominate a elected official?
You currently have an elected county official. You can elect either a city elected or non-elected to this position, which would then make the secretary position available for a city elected, if this is a non-elected.
If I'm correct, she's asking, but can she have a non-elected? You can nominate a non-elected also.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
She may.
Okay.
Can we re-nominate Commissioner Suarez to vice chair?
Vice chair.
I believe you can, because it's the period of time in the specific position that is not allowed. And so he can be any other position as an officer.
I'd like to nominate Councilman Mike Suarez to vice chair.
Okay. We have Director Jarosz and Director Suarez as nominations so far. Are there any further nominations?
If I could, let me remove my name from nomination for vice chair. In my mind, I think Karen's done a great job as a vice chair, so if that's okay. I don't know if
you may do that.
It's your name. You can do whatever you want.
You have to
deal with that. That's what my mother says to me all the time. So,
so last offer. Any further nominations from the floor? Seeing none, we close the nominations. All in favor of Ms. Jarosz as the vice chair, please indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? It's unanimous. Now we need someone nominated for the treasurer, and this needs to be a municipal elected. If one is willing and able to serve. If not, then it can go to anyone. So your policy says.
So, municipal elections would include
Mike Suarez.
No, you have.
We have two municipal elections.
You have Temple Terrace and you have the city of Tampa. So, you've
okay.
got a body
so
of two.
Sure we're clear. That's
yes, sir. It's not a wide field.
Wonderful, but small.
Okay, do I hear any nominations for the position of secretary? Yes, sir.
I'll nominate Councilman Suarez.
I'll second.
Okay, we have Councilman Suarez as a nomination. Are there any further nominations? Seeing none, we'll close the nominations. All in favor of electing Mr. Suarez as the secretary, please indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It's unanimous. I now turn the meeting over to the chair to run the balance of the elections. I'm available to assist in any way you would like.
Commissioner, if you could, why don't you come here? Because this way you can direct the board properly.
Congratulations.
Well, they, first of all, let me say Happy New Year, everyone, and thank you for your vote of confidence in allowing me to chair this body. We have a lot to do this year. We have a lot of issues we have to face, and we're going to make some of those determinations today. But as a board, we've got to come together and work on the betterment of this county, all of our district municipalities. We have an excellent executive director who's constantly on the phone with me talking about certain issues, and I'm glad she does that because we all need to come together. We have a legislative session coming in this year. We don't know what's going to happen there, but we need to be vigilant about that. We have a new administration coming into Washington, D.C., so we have to very, very be careful of what's happening there and stay on top of what's going on there. We need to bring funding into our county for this board and this agency that we can continue to serve our citizens. So I thank you for allowing me to work to serve you as your chair. I look forward to working with each and every one of you. As our senior hall used to say, let's get busy. So our next on the agenda is public input on the agenda item. Is anyone? I'm sorry. Thank you. Get with me. We'll approve of the minutes from December 5th, 2016. We have a motion to approve the minutes.
So moved. Second.
Motion by Mr. Suarez, who's the second by Mr. McClain. Any further discussion? Mr. Smith?
No, after you finish that.
Okay. Any further discussion? All those in favor, let it be known by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposes likewise. Motion's adopted. Now moving to public comment.
And Mr. Chair, before you go there, if I might, you actually have several committees that are elected committees that I think we need to deal with currently. The nominations for the balance of the committees is at your discretion based upon the input you've received, and you may do that at any time between now and whenever the committees need to meet. But we do need to have a nomination and set of elections for the first two committees under two, which is the Claims and Litigation Committee and the ADA Committee, and also the three committees under subpart three, which is the Streetcar, MPO, and Transportation and Disadvantaged Coordinating Board. The rest of the committees are by chair nomination, or chair appointment, excuse me.
So we have the claims. What's the other one?
Yes, sir. The first one would be the claims committee. And you've got in your materials the current member and those who expressed interest.
And that is, Mr. Sirup, you're the only one that showed interest in that. So is anyone, is there any nominations on the floor of serving on this? Yes, ma'am.
I'd like to nominate Director Crino to the position of Chair of the Claims and Litigation Committee.
Nomination Director Crino. Any further nominations? Any further nominations? Any further nominations? The nominations close on the said name. All those in favor of Mr. Crino serving as a member of the Claims and Litigation Committee, let me know by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed likewise. Motion's adopted. Congratulations, sir. Mr. Smith, what's the next one?
The HART ADA Committee. The current person is Councilman Eddie Vance. He's no longer on the board. The person who's expressed interest is Commissioner Sandra Merman.
I nominate Sandy
Merman. There's a motion by to nominate Commissioner Merman of the HART ADA Committee. Is there any further nominations? Are there any further nominations? Are there any further nominations? Nomination closed on said name. All those in favor of Sandy Merman serving as the HART ADA Committee, let me know by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed likewise. Motion is adopted. Congratulations.
Mr. Chairman, we need to go back and elect an alternate for the Claims Committee. My apology. We skip straight to the next committee.
Okay.
The current alternate is Ms. Shanahan. The only expressed interest is Commissioner Stacy White to serve as the alternate for the Claims Committee.
Commissioner White.
And Mr. Chairman, I only put my name down as expressing interest just in the event that the current member was no longer interested, but I'll happily nominate Director Shanahan to continue to serve.
No, I didn't put, I put my name not down for a purpose. Trust me. Right. This group has way too many committees.
Commissioner White, Ms. Shanahan declined Commissioner White, so Commissioner White, you've been nominated now. you kept opening your mouth. Are there any further nominations? Are there any further nominations? Are there any further nominations? See no further nominations. Nomination closed. Mr. White's been nominated as the current, as the alternate for the Claims and Litigation Committee. And seeing no further nominations, all those in favor, let them know by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed likewise. Motion adopted. Now I think I need to do an alternate for the ADA Committee.
Yes, sir.
Is there? I'm a nominations on the floor for alternate.
I'd like to nominate Mr. Melendez, Director Melendez.
Director Melendez has been nominated. Any further nominations? Are there any further nominations? Any further nominations? Nominations closed. Name of Mr. Melendez. All those in favor, let it be known by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, likewise. Motion adopted. Congratulations, sir. Anything else, sir?
Yes, sir. The next one on the next page, your external board appointments. First one is Tampa Historic Streetcar. As you can see, the current members are three, Mr. Jacob, Ms. Shanahan, and Mr. Vance. The expressed interest is Mr. Jacob. And there's two that have expressed interest to be alternates.
Okay. Are there any nominations for the Tampa Historic Streetcar Incorporated Board?
I nominate Nikki Jacobs.
Mr. Jacobs has been nominated. Any further nominations? Are there any further nominations?
I would like, since they expressed interest, Mr. Bowers and Councilman Swartz. Are we doing multiple?
You need three to serve in this position. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so if I could nominate both Mr. Bowers and Councilman Suarez.
Mr. Bowers and Councilman Suarez have been nominated. That makes three. Are there any further nominations? Nominations are closed on the names of Mr. Jacob, Mr. Bowers, and Mr. Suarez. All those in favor, let me know by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, likewise. Motion is adopted.
We also have three alternates that we need to elect for that position to serve in case the three electeds, those who were elected to serve, do not or are unable to.
The floor is now open for nominations for alternates to the Tampa Historic Streetcar Board. Commissioner White.
I nominate Councilwoman Donahue.
Councilwoman Donahue has been nominated. Any further nominations?
We need two more.
Two more.
Okay. I nominate Ms. Jaroche.
Ms. Jaroche has been nominated.
It's alternate. I'm sorry. alternate, yes. Okay.
It's alternate.
Hey, I got trapped into this too, so I might be glad you're
dragging me in there.
Ms. Jaroche. Ms. Jaroche has been nominated. Any further nominations? Ms. Jacob.
Yes, I'd like to nominate Commissioner Kemp.
Commissioner Kemp has been nominated. Any further nominations? Are there any further nominations? Nominations closing. Said three names of Donahue, Jaroche, and Kemp. Seeing no further nominations, all those in favor, let me know saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, likewise. Motion is adopted. Congratulations.
Next is the Metropolitan Planning Organization. We have one member who serves in that capacity. Currently, that's Mr. Bowers. You will note that six people indicated interest: Mr. Bowers, Mr. Crino, Ms. Jaroche, Mr. McLean, Mr. Melendez, and Ms. Shanahan.
The floor is now open for nominations for member of the MPO board. Mr. Jacob.
I would like to nominate Mr. Bowers.
Mr. Bowers has been nominated. Are there any further nominations? Nominations closed in the same name of Mr. Wallace Bowers on the MPO board. All those in favor, let them know, saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, likewise. Motion is adopted. Mr. Bowers, you're still remaining on the MPO board.
We now need to elect an alternate, and those who expressed interest are Ms. Shanahan, Mr. Crino, Ms. Donahue, Mr. Jacob, Ms. Jaroche, Mr. McLean, and Mr. Melendez.
The floor is now open for nomination for alternate to the MPO board. Commissioner White.
I nominate Director Shanahan.
Director Shanahan has been nominated as alternate to the MPO board. Any further nominations? Nominations are closed in the same name of Director Shanahan as the alternate of the MPO board. All those in favor, let them know by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, likewise. Motion is adopted. Mr. Shanahan, congratulations.
The last nomination and the last election is for Transportation and Disadvantaged Coordinating Board. The current member is Commissioner White. The expressed interest category appears to be blank.
Commissioner White, you recognize.
Mr. Chairman, I'm happy to continue to serve on that board if I'm called to. I have to tell you that the day and time in which they meet is no longer really ideal for me. So I'd like to see if maybe one of our new members, perhaps Commissioner Kemp or Councilwoman Donahue, might be interested in picking up that board. It really is a great board that really has a great mission and a great purpose.
What is the date and time?
Mm-hmm. It's on Fridays. I believe 10:30 is the time. We'll just say late morning, four Fridays per year.
Okay. Are there any nominations for the Transportation Disadvantaged Coordinating Board?
I recommend Commissioner Kemp.
Commissioner Kemp has been nominated. Are there any further nominations? Are there any further nominations? Nominations closed in the same name of Commissioner Kemp. All those in favor, let it be known by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, likewise. Motion is adopted. Congratulations, Commissioner Kemp.
And the very last position is that of alternate for that same board. And the current alternate was Commissioner Merman. Again, the expressed interest category is blank.
Is there any nominations for alternate? Yes, sir.
I'd like to nominate Director Donahue.
Donahue has been nominated for alternate. Any further nominations? Are there any further nominations? Are there any further nominations? Nomination is closed in the name of Mr. Donahue. All those in favor, let me know by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed is likewise. Motion is adopted.
And Mr. Chairman, the balance of the committees are appointed by the chair. You have the information in front of you. You may make those appointments as you, at the time period you deem appropriate.
I will do that, sir. Thank you. Okay, we're now moving to the input from the public. I have the name of Sharon Calvert. Ms. Calvert, good morning. Welcome. You have 3 minutes.
Good morning and happy new year. Regarding agenda item 2, the hiring of lobbyists, I hope you will be cognizant of where our state legislature may be going with regards to lobbyists being hired by taxpayer-funded agencies. Agenda item 6.2 regarding the MPO. The recent rule pushed through on December 20th, 2016 to dictate regional MPOs seems to be the impetus for pursuing an agenda for regionalism in the Tampa Bay area. Our FDOT and the Florida's MPO Advisory Council opposed the rule, which is another federal overreach into state and local control. And I believe that rule is behind perhaps looking again at a merger between PSTA and HART, which I oppose. Local control is always better. History has proven that bigger bureaucracies only get bigger and more powerful, especially when they're distanced from those most impacted. I believe also you need to, it could be that this rule pushed through at the last minute by an administration that's basically leaving may be eliminated anyway through the Midnight Rules Act, H.R. 21, that is now in the Senate. And then the last item I'd just like to mention is that I do have a concern about the premium transit study. I know it's just starting, and I'll be seeing how this plays out. But I hope that we're spending $1.5 million of taxpayer money to study again, to study a study, and that it does not turn into another taxpayer-funded campaign. Thank you.
Thank you. That's the only name I have on the sign-in list to speak. Is there anyone else wishing to speak at this point in time? Okay. Now moving to the presentation of the Federal Legislative Services Proposal. Mr. Vaughn. Good morning.
Good morning, Mr. Chair. Congratulations. Good morning, fellow board members. On July 18th, at the July 18th board meeting, I was instructed to exercise the option for state legislative consulting services, and we exercised the option with the advocacy board. Staff was instructed to go out and publicly compete the federal legislative consulting services. I would like to thank the following people for the participation on the evaluation committee, headed by Cesar Hernandez and Lena Pettit, members from the Tampa Bay Partnership, Tampa International Airport, the Tampa Chamber of Commerce, all participated in the evaluation process. This morning, I bring before you the action item to authorize the Chief Executive Officer to enter into negotiations and to award an 18-month contract with 2 one-year options for federal legislative consulting services. The purpose of this item is to view the presentations by the 3 offerors and authorize the CEO to enter into negotiations and subsequent contract with the most qualified candidate. The financial impact funding for this contract in FY 2017 is currently appropriated in the HART adopted FY 2017 operating budget. Renewal years will be budgeted as appropriate and funded with general operating revenues. The background contains detailed portions of the scope of work. It outlines exactly what the federal legislative consultant will be doing for us. On September 26th, our RFP for federal legislative consulting services was issued in compliance with HART procurement policies. Solicitation was posted on the HART website and the Manstar website with direct notices sent to register to register vendors. The solicitation was accessed from HART website by 18 firms or individuals. On October 21st, 2016, three responses were received for federal legislative consulting services. An evaluation selection committee comprised of HART staff, Cesar Hernandez, Alina Pettit, Bryant, Pat Mentra from Tampa Bay Partnership, Gina Davis, Tampa International Airport, and Wendy Brill, Tampa Chamber of Commerce, evaluated and scored proposals. Review factors were weighted 700 points for technical and 300 points for pricing. Technical factors were included qualifications of the firm, 300 points, qualifications of the staff, 100 points, work plan, 300 points, price, 300 points. In your packets, you see the actual breakdown on a chart that shows the three firms that submitted, Holland & Knight, Potomac Partners, D.C., McAllister & Quinn, LLC. Below that chart, below the technical, is the price, Holland & Knight, at $327,000, annually. Potomac Partners, D.C., $348,000, McAllister & Quinn, LLC, $420,000. The Legislative and Strategic Planning Committee met on December 19th and reviewed the scores. The committee members approved staff recommendations for all three offers to present to the full HART Board of Directors at the January 9th staff board meeting. This morning, Mr. Chair, all three firms, I sent out a letter on December 20th inviting all three firms to come in and present this morning to you. In the letter that I submitted, there were three questions that were asked at the committee. Those three questions were, what changes in federal transportation funding policy, specifically regarding transit, do you see coming in the new administration, if any? What changes do you foresee your agency making to adjust to the new administration? Do you anticipate the ban on congressional earmarks being lifted? And if so, what challenges might that present your agency? Would this enhance or harm HART's opportunity for federal funding based on project merit? The third and last question, does the firm have a transition / work plan if awarded to someone other than the incumbent? Additionally, through the clerk of the board, sent another email out to the board members asking if they had any further questions. No further questions were submitted. This morning, I would like to bring all three firms to the board to present. They have a total of 10 minutes to present, 5 minutes for Q&A. I have them all in a side conference room, and I chose to have them present in alphabetical order. Are there any questions, Mr. Chair?
Are there any questions, Mr. Byrne?
Just real quick on format. So the competing firms won't be able to hear the specific questions we ask, so they'll be fresh if we ask the questions of all three?
Correct.
Is that correct?
All three. None of the firms will hear the presentation nor the questions that will be asked. Additionally, after the last presenter comes forward and presents, I've asked all three firms to stay in the conference room. That way, it'll give you the luxury, afford you the ability to have discussion.
Any other questions, Mr. Byrne? Okay, Mr. Burns, will we start off with Holland & Knight?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Good morning.
Morning.
Thank you very much for having us here this morning. My name is Rich Gold. I'm head of the public policy group at Holland & Knight. First off, we want to start out by thanking your board for working with us this past year. It's been an honor to serve you all, and we're here this morning to ask you to continue working with us as we go forward so that we can help the region achieve its transit goals. The Public Policy Group at Holland & Knight is a group of 90 professionals and lawyers in Washington, D.C. and around the country who focus on local government and transit representation, corporate representation, and nonprofit representations. We are one of the top three lobbying firms in Washington at this point. We're bipartisan, split down the middle, Republican and Democrat. We've been very successful, I think, in working with HART, the time we've been working with you. Obviously, had strong success last year with the Bus and Bus Facilities Grant, the only one approved in the state of Florida because of our abilities both with the delegation and with the Department of Transportation and the great work that you all do at the staff level and the board level. And over the period of time, we've been working with you all a total of $40 million in federal funds coming back to HART as a result. I want to thank my colleagues for being here this morning, especially Governor Martinez from coming over from our Tampa office. In addition to Governor Martinez, Governor Frank Keating, former governor of Oklahoma, and a half dozen of our colleagues are involved with the Trump transition and will be working closely with the administration as things move forward. One of the great things about working at a bipartisan firm is being able to adjust regardless of who's in the White House and who's running the committees on Capitol Hill, and we've demonstrated a strong capability to do that. Also, my colleague Lisa Barkovic, who has been the general day-to-day person, having served in the Florida delegation on the Republican side for many years before coming to Holland & Knight. Carl Koch, who's here in our Tampa office and splits his time between Tampa and D.C., working with Senator Nelson's office and the House Democrat delegation. And Jeff Booth of Booth Transit Consulting, who brings to us the strongest technical expertise in the industry and working with FTA on everything from the New Starts process to bus and bus facilities funding, et cetera. So with that, let me hand over to Lisa, and we'll move from there.
Thanks, Rich. Again, good morning. Thank you for the opportunity to be here. I'm Lisa Barkovic, a senior policy advisor at Holland & Knight. I've been with Holland & Knight for the past 12 years representing local governments and transit agencies and transportation authorities before the federal government. And as Rich mentioned, prior to that, I spent almost 5 years as a Republican House staffer working in the Florida delegation. And in my previous life, too, I've been an executive board member of the Florida State Society. Just real quickly about Holland & Knight, we know not only Hillsborough County, but we know your members of the delegation very well. Congresswoman Castor, Congressman Ross, Congressman Buchanan, Congressman Bilirakis, they've all been great supporters of HART, and we work really closely and well with them. And I think, as Rich mentioned, we got the only bus and bus facilities grant for the state of Florida for HART last year, which was a great success, and I think that owes to a lot of utilizing our relationships, not only within the delegation, but at the federal government. We have extremely strong working relationships with Senator Nelson, who's going to be the ranking member on Senate Commerce again this year, and Senator Marco Rubio, who's now going to be on the Senate Appropriations Committee and will offer some new opportunities to HART in this coming fiscal year. In addition to strengthening your relationships with the delegation, we have great relationships, as Mike and Jeff will talk about shortly, with the House Transportation Infrastructure Committee and Senate Banking Committee. We are prepared to help with the Trump transition. We have active members right now of Holland & Knight that are working with the transition teams, helping them go through nominees and write the policy papers. And I'm going to turn it over to Mike here, Mike Friedberg, one of my colleagues.
Hi, my name is Mike Friedberg. I'm the newest member of the Holland & Knight team. I started in September 2015, about 15 months ago or 16 months ago. I was this Republican staff director for the subcommittee on rail for Chairman Schuster, so I was the senior staff. Before that, I was a Republican committee staff on the Transportation, Housing, and Urban Development Committee, and worked for Chairman Rogers on that committee. And then before that, I was at the Office of Management and Budget. What I'm most proud of is that I have relationships with both the members, including Chairman Diaz-Balart of FUD, and close relationship with Chairman Schuster, but I also have very good relationships with their senior staff. So you kind of need that combination of both the member-level interests and then the staff who actually draft the policy. With respect to earmarks, when I was on the House Appropriations Committee, I did two cycles of earmarks. So if they come back, we're in a very strong position to assist you with that. However, as you saw, you know, there is strong support within the Republican Conference to getting earmarks back. But as you saw by the ethics reform, if you didn't, they tried to change the ethics office. The press and President-elect Trump kind of fought back. And we kind of foresee that that might actually happen again if earmarks are attempted to be passed. But we're in good shape both ways. You're going to hear from Jeff, and with my experience at OMB, the Office of Management Budget, the 2018 budget, which will be President-elect Trump's first budget, will be his most important and his kind of issues. Most of it's going to be done with career staff help. We have very close relationships with the senior staff at OMB, the senior career staff at OMB and FTA, and I think that's going to be really, really important in forming the next administration's policies, especially with respect to transit. With that, Jeff.
Thanks, Mike. It's good to be back. My name is Jeff Booth, the president of Booth Transit Consulting, and until 18 months ago was with Holland & Knight. I've represented HART for 20 years. So I've been here coming to HART for 20 years watching what's happened in the Tampa region. So I have a long history with the region and a long history with this agency. In addition to that, prior to entering the practice of law, I worked for 10 years on Capitol Hill for Senator Mark Hatfield of Oregon, Republican, chairman of the Appropriations Committee. I've worked 5 years on his personal staff and 5 years on his Senate Appropriations Committee staff with the focus on surface transportation, the Transportation, Housing, and Urban Development Bill. So I have a deep history in transportation appropriations. And as the firm name implies, the focus on transit, that's all I do is focus on transit nationwide. But I also have very deep relationships with FTA career staff. In fact, I'm missing a meeting with them today right now at the After Policy and Planning Committees. We're looking at the coming year and sort of where this administration is going, where they expect it to be going. But the most important thing for the next couple of months is that Matt Welbus, who's the current chief of staff for FTA, will be the acting FTA administrator. And I've worked with Matt for over 20 years. So in terms of issues arising within the agency, we're well taken care of there and through those relationships. As Mike talked about, we are in sort of the midst of FY17 right now. The bill's been extended until April 28th. What does that mean for you? It means that right now FTA will issue an apportionments notice based on FY16 funding levels sometime in the next couple of weeks that'll carry us through for 7 months until the end of the appropriations bill. I don't expect that there'll be a lot of changes in FY17. We'll finally bring the bills to resolution for funding, but I would say we should be looking very closely at the FY18 budget, both in terms of what's happening on Capitol and what will come out of the Trump administration. On Capitol Hill, there's lots of discussion about rolling back the domestic caps and going back to FY15 levels. That means then that we'll, and in addition, there's a desire to increase defense spending. And so we're going to see that no longer them rising at equal levels that we're actually going to see defense rise faster than domestic. In addition, there's some talk in the House about taking the trust fund programs like the mass transit account, pulling them into the budget, and counting them among the domestic caps. And heretofore, those trust funds have always been treated outside of the budget process. And so that's important to you because that's the possibility through the FY18 budget coming out of Congress and out of the administration, some reductions in 5307 or 5339 programs for the bus and bus facilities. So those are things to be paying very close attention to at HART because they can have real fiscal impact in future years. So I think that's something we'll be certainly monitoring you for you and keeping an eye on for you. In addition, in terms of the Trump administration, there's been a tremendous amount of talk about $1 billion infrastructure bill. It's important to understand that that's infrastructure defined very broadly. So that's utilities, that's water, that's ports, that's airports, it's highways. Not a lot of mention about transit. What we do understand so far, a lot of talk coming out of the administration is a lot of talk about really two principal things. One, taking foreign revenues that are currently overseas, offering them a lower tax break to repatriate those monies back into the United States with a commitment to invest those monies in transportation. Now, the form of that investment remains to be seen. There are qualified tax credit bonds, there are municipal bonds. There's also the possibility of creating incentives through some of the existing financing programs such as TIFIA and RIF to invest in surface transportation. Now, the issue with each of those, certainly from the investment, the financing side, is that that requires a dedicated local funding source, either at a state or local level, to repay the debt. So it's not free money. There still has to be a dedicated funding source that will repay that debt over a 25 or 30 or 35-year period, depending on the source of funding or financing that you decide to employ. So it still relies on local money to sort of do debt repayment if you're going to bring those private sector dollars in as an investment. So I think that's important to sort of keep in mind. And so we do expect that that bill will come up probably sometime late spring. They've indicated right now that that will follow two budget resolutions that will be passed. First, really focusing on the Affordable Care Act. The second will be focusing on tax, sort of the tax program, and sort of looking at adjusting both corporate and or individual tax rates. We are crossing our fingers that there might be some possibility of addressing the long-term financing for surface transportation in the second budget resolution bill. Mitch McConnell, Senate Majority Leader, has always talked about addressing any sort of long-term solution for surface transportation in that bill, so we are cautiously optimistic that, in fact, there may be some long-term funding source in that bill. Thank you very much.
And with that, we'll just open it up to questions. Just let me say thank you very much for having us here this morning. We really appreciate it. We think we're uniquely positioned to help you with the new administration, the new Congress, both on the infrastructure bill, appropriations, city stand earmarks are back, as well as DOT, the Secretary Chow. Thank you.
Are there any questions? Yes, Mr. Flores.
What is your relationship with the new designated DOT secretary?
We have a good relationship with Secretary Chow. I think we have very good high-level contact. She's, as opposed to some of the other nominees, she is an old Washington hand. She's been around town. She's obviously married to Senator McConnell. And we've had relationships with her when she was Deputy Secretary of DOT as well as when she was Secretary of Labor on a working basis.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks.
Ms. Sinan, recognize.
First of all, very impressive group and presentation, and I think it's going to be a very dynamic time in Washington, D.C. as it relates to transportation, innovation, infrastructure, all that in together. And I would just say, I know several people that they're talking to about running the infrastructure project out of the White House that would deal with the appropriate agencies to spearhead that. And that would include a lot of P3s. It will also be really innovation, new technology implementation. And I think we should make sure we stay in touch with that. So if there are pilots and opportunities for us to get, be the example, which I know we've done a couple of times in terms of what Catherine and the team have pursued, please let them know we're open to that. I mean, I'm really open to that. I people talk about transit. I'm not sure transit's going to happen after the billion-dollar overrun of the trail out in California, but when you have driverless cars and you have the whole way of buses, I mean, there's a whole evolution that's coming that we don't even know. And I would just like to make sure that the entire team thinks about big opportunities. And I know when new administrations, there's always looking for pilots. And Florida's an important state to Mr. Trump. It's an important state in the country. And we're an important part of the state because we really represent, sort of all of the, we're sort of a nexus of opportunities. So I would just really encourage, I know there's the perfunctory process of Washington, D.C., and I think you have your levers on all of that. I have total confidence in that. But don't miss the nuances just to get us a report on some committee. There's going to be opportunities for fast-moving, innovative thinking, opportunistic funding. And I'd like to make sure that you think about HART as an agency to fulfill that.
Absolutely. And one of the things that we're working on with HART right now is HART, along with THEA and Cutter with University of South Florida, have submitted an application to be one of the designated automated vehicle proving grounds, which I think would benefit HART as it looks towards its demonstration projects and pilots that it has with driverless vehicles.
Right.
And I think it would be absolutely wonderful. We're continuing to work with this and Secretary Fox to hopefully make sure that designation happens.
Yeah, I guess Secretary Chow, or Secretary Designate Chow, has already indicated strong support for AVs.
Yep.
And wanting to be involved in supporting the technology. And I think one of the biggest issues that's going to have to be resolved is this level of oversight. And at what level does that oversight take place? Is it federal, to NHTSA? Mm-hmm. Is it state? And so far, each of the states who've sort of chosen to step into that arena have taken somewhat of a different perspective on the level of oversight, right? And so one of the challenges for the AFE manufacturers is how do we comply with 50 different state laws?
Right.
And so I think that's one of the issues of resolving those issues, and especially sort of in an urban environment, one of the challenges so far with AVEs, because coming with AVEs comes a whole new signage, a whole new set of vehicle-to-vehicle, vehicle-to-infrastructure communication that has to take place, and all that's going to cost money. And so the issue is, where does that money come from to make that investment? But you're right, it's coming. It's absolutely coming, and I think it's, and I think that, so this administration will be on board and sort of supporting that and trying to fund that. And I think there's a large role for the private sector in investing in a lot of that infrastructure. I think that's where you're going to see some of the leveraging taking place, is private sector investment to sort of introduce these technologies and really enhance the technology that happens. But it's also going to have a local cost, because virtually every road sign that we have today will have to be changed.
Right.
And so it's something that isn't going to happen right away. It's going to be a period of time, and it also has a land use effect in terms of where people live, where do we park the vehicles, how do we deal with the vehicles that are on the roads, can we narrow the lanes because the vehicles are shorter and narrower than current automobiles. There's a lot of issues for regions to wrestle with, and I think transit has the opportunity to be the innovator, because I think it's a place where you can run a driverless bus and identify a route with good signage and good sort of roads in terms of markings on the road to be able to guide the bus, that you can, we can be one of the innovators for that. So I agree with you. I think there's huge opportunities to look at that. And you're right, that's where the marketplace wants to go right now.
I was just going to say, process-wise, you know, to get those pilots in there right now, you're going to have to go top-down and bottom-up. Top-down from Congress and our efforts there, but you're really going to need bottom-up from OMB and FTA.
Yeah.
And I was a career at OMB during the Bush to Obama transition, and what they're doing now is coming up with those ideas.
Yep.
So you need to get in with those people and have that reach that kind of Frank and Jeff and I have to kind of get those ideas planted.
Right.
Because if they pick up those ideas and present it to the, you know, they're currently working with the transition team right now coming up with those ideas.
As somebody who led a transition, I totally understand. That's why I raised the issue.
Any further questions? Yes, Mr. Jeff.
Yeah, this is really terrific stuff, but I do have a question, two questions actually, very quickly. One is, how do you plan your communication of your activities through Mr. Hernandez back to us so we understand what's going on? I think this board has expressed here recently that we want to be more on top of what's really happening in terms of the issues and how you're dealing with them. And then number two, can part of your strategy be looking at how we can also participate this, in particular when Congress is out of session and the members are back at home, and how we can foster some of the work that you're doing here locally to build those relationships? And I'd like to see how you feel about that, or what you think you can do to help us do that.
Absolutely. So right now what we have a monthly call that includes senior management, includes Ms. Egan, as well as Mr. Hernandez, and other senior management members from HART. We also try to, on a daily basis, when things come up that we think that we need to flag for HART, I'll send emails to Mr. Hernandez or pick up the phone and call him and just kind of let him know. Or sometimes it's just calling and saying, checking in, hey, what's going on? You know, saw the local press this morning. You know, things seem pretty quiet. How is that really the case? One of the things that we're doing moving forward, too, is we're going to be providing monthly reports. And as the congressional and administration activity speeds up, we're going to be doing a much more regular contact so you guys are aware of what's happening in Washington and what that means for HART.
Going back to a previous question, one of the reasons why you all have been successful so far is because of the work that Ms. Egan and staff have done. Both down here, but also being active in Washington. And I think you all being active down here with the delegation when they're home, as well as you've done in the past, have meetings up in Washington, is very important. We're there to help the process and help move things along, but we don't have the authority of being elected the way you all do and speaking for the region on transit issues the way you all do. When you do come up to Washington, as you all know, those are, you know, 10-minute in the office. They're kind of crazed meetings. It's a very busy time while they're up there. And when they're down here, they have more time to meet and sit and ask questions. So I think if you all can arrange your schedules as such so that when you're here you can be doing that and we can help coordinate that, that is a great way, a great addition to what we're already doing.
Good. Thank you.
Any further questions? Seeing none, thank you very much. Mr. Burns.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. At this time, we could bring McAllister in, or I don't know if you want to have a conversation here before we do that.
No conversation now, just go ahead and bring in McAllister Quinn.
Okay. I'm David Grenham. I'm Vice President of Business Development and Client Services at McAllister & Quinn, and we're glad to be here. Thank you for having us. I've got some colleagues here with me, and I'll introduce them in a moment. And I just want to let you know that we've brought together a pretty competent team here that we think we can achieve some pretty significant return on investment for HART, and I'd like to talk about that in a little while. But before I get there, let me introduce Alan Boyd, who's a part of our team. And Alan, if you could just introduce yourself.
Thank you, David. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, I'm privileged to stand before you. I recognize a few familiar faces here. To introduce myself, I live in North Florida. I spent a little time in Tallahassee in the state legislature in the late 80s and early 90s. Several people around the table I had an opportunity to serve with. I did see a gentleman in the audience that came in earlier that was the first governor when I was in the state legislature serving with Les Miller and Commissioner Berman, and I didn't get to serve together, but our paths almost crossed as she came into the State House Representative just as I left, and Ms. Shanahan was doing a little work down there too, and we had a chance to interact a little bit. I served 8 years in the state legislature, serving that coastal district, basically from Apalachicola down to below Crystal River. I had an opportunity there to serve with Les Miller and Dan Webster and Lois Frankel, folks who are pertinent in this discussion that we're having today. I went to the U.S. Congress in 1997 and had a chance to serve there for 14 years, and 12 of those years serving on the Appropriations Committee of the U.S. House of Representatives, serving Tallahassee, Panama City. What's pertinent about that is that I had a chance to work with those leaders in those communities on their transportation upgrade issues and infrastructure issues. I represent, I'm the principal of a small boutique firm called Kinney Policy Group, and we put this team together for the specific purpose of responding to this RFP. My role is role on Capitol Hill, and to capitalize on those relationships that we've had over the years, including relationships with the two senators that are running the Senate Transportation Committee, John Thune, the chairman, and also our own Senator Bill Nelson, the ranking member. Also, Bill Schuster, the chairman of the House Transportation Committee, and his subcommittee chairman, Sam Graves, have traveled to this part of the state with me on a number of occasions working on different issues. So I'm delighted to be a part of this team, and thank you very much for letting us present.
I am here. My colleague Melissa Hamp couldn't be here, who would be part of our team, so I'm standing in for her. I'm not going to talk too much about our firm other than what we're bringing to the table here is the strategic grant component of the services that we want to talk with you about. And we'll talk a little bit more later about how that works. I'd like Jeff to introduce
you. Thank you, David. My name is Jeff Sharkey. I'm out of Tallahassee. I am a 25 years in the lobbying business, state level, local level as well. And the reason I'm on this team, and I think David and Alan have touched on this, but David will go into more detail, what we really thought we would provide for the HART team is a three-part strategy. One, on the Hill, Alan Boyd, where we work on policy issues, work on and convincing members to support various transportation, innovative transportation initiatives. David's firm really focuses on grant development, grant solicitation, grant recruitment. And we'll talk a little bit more about that with earmarks going, why that's significantly important for HART. I'm on the team, I bought another team, because my job is to really bring together state and private partners to this discussion, try to assist with developing P3 relationships, as well as linking and matching funds at state level and at the federal level, as well as private sector stuff. I've worked extensively for years in the transportation industry. In Tallahassee, created the Florida Intermodal Transportation Association, ports, airports, public transit, rail, and even space to really develop the first CIS system, strategic intermodal system, with Senator Jim Sabesco, who I know all you know. We've worked on that extensively. Currently, I work representing a variety of innovative transportation technology companies. We're trying to bring to the table as well to represent Tesla, represent SpaceX, all of Elon Musk's companies, as well as a variety of hydrogen fuel cell companies. Any people involved in kind of disruptive technologies, which are all kind of moving toward where HART is going. I'm very impressed with the innovative focus on intelligent transportation systems that HART has undertaken. We had an opportunity to work in bringing Tesla to the table for your HART for Link program. Work with your staff here was very, very exciting. It's the first ever for Tesla in the country. It's those kinds of relationships I think we can continue to build with HART, both with federal money, state, potentially state money, and private sector involved. So my job really will be to link and communicate and coordinate with your regional partners, Go Hillsborough, TVARTA, your other partners, as well as TransDev and the Economic Development Associations you've got here, as well as with Senator Brandis, Senator Young, the folks here who are going to really be looking at with budget the way they are in Tallahassee, matching up funds and creating innovative partnerships. So we're very focused on trying to help achieve your intelligent transportation solutions. And I think this team, the three parts of this team, will work very closely with your group to get that done.
Great. Thank you, Jeff. So we talked a little bit about how our team will work together. Like I said, our firm, McAllister & Quinn, is focused, I would say 70% of our business is focused on strategic grant development and trying to find a return on investment. And I think that there are numerous grant opportunities that we would try to pursue should HART decide to work with us. And our methodology would be to make that grant process part of our strategic plan, and we would have to integrate that grant seeking, because that's where the money is. It's with the federal agencies, and now that earmarks are gone, and there's, you know, we've talked about a possibility of them coming back, but it would be great if they did, but I wouldn't count on it. And I think that as innovative as HART is, I think there are opportunities for pursuing some federal grants that maybe you haven't thought about before, and particularly with some of the things that Jeff had mentioned. And so we want to get to what we might expect to happen and talk about and then take some of your questions. We think there will be opportunity, particularly with this infrastructure plan that President-elect Trump has mentioned. Not sure exactly what's going to happen with that, but we know that there's opportunity there, and we think that meeting with the transition team and trying to get as active as possible now with the transition team and other advisors that Trump has now at the table would be critical for HART, and that's something that we think we could help you with. We only have about 10 minutes, but we have time for questions. We want to start any questions now.
Any questions?
What's your, I know it's hard to guarantee results. First of all, Congressman Boyd, it's great to see you again. And I do have fond memories of our exchanges in Tallahassee when I was there. In terms of grants, yeah, I doubt that. In terms of grants and getting grants, I mean, I don't know how successful HART has pursued that historically, and I'll ask Caesar when he comes up, but I just am curious as to, are there avenues that we have not pursued that we should be pursuing? And, you know, I know there's no guarantee, but what's your deliverable rate in terms of what you, you know, 60% grants get funded at 60% of the, I mean, is there any sort of measurement numeric that you could establish some sort of a bar that we could evaluate as part of the evaluation?
Yeah, I think we have to be careful about making promises.
I understand that.
Grants, and it really depends on the agency that we represent. Generally speaking, I would say 1 out of 3 is a pretty good metric. For you know, the past 5 years we've been doing this, when the earmarks went away, we developed basically converted our business from the whole earmarking world to the grant development world. And we have about 250 grant writers that we rely on that are part of our network, and we're doing this in a different way. And so, absolutely, you can't guarantee results, but the thing that we would want to be doing is coming down here, figuring out where your strengths are, where the partnerships might exist to pursue some of these opportunities, and then pursue on a regular basis, meaning about every 90 days, a grant proposal. You want to keep them going, and you want to imagine a conveyor belt of opportunities that we would want to try to pursue. And so I'm estimating about 1 per quarter that we would want to try to get a rhythm going to try to get you in front of the agencies.
If I could add, and I know that The standard success rate for a grant application at the federal agency is somewhere at 8% or less.
Yeah.
You know, mm-hmm. So what McAllister and Quinn has done, what this team has done, is developed a stable of 250 professional grant writers across all areas of jurisdiction that we rely on that deal with those agencies on a daily basis. And so that's what you would have access to it, and that increases that probability of success up to somewhere 32-38%.
I see one of your clients is the University of Clemson. I hope you're going to the game.
That's what I was thinking.
I see it on your representative client list.
Good luck.
That's Drew, recognize.
Yes, I'm going to ask a question that my counterpart did earlier. How do you envision working with our government relations team member here at HART, Caesar, and also was interested in, is that going to be Melissa doing the grant work, or would it be part of that 250? I just kind of wasn't clear on how that process works.
So to your question, obviously we have kind of three focuses here. I mean, they're going to be combined in kind of a comprehensive strategy. So McAllister and Quinn team, Melissa will be working on the whole, let's identify the grants that we can apply for. And I think, we'll come back to this, but HART is doing some, I'm not trying to be too polite, but HART is doing some very innovative things. I mean, you've got a whole range of transit options, you're pushing the edges on trying of pilot projects, and it's pretty impressive. I'm not trying to be too polite here, but I think with when we talked through this, and there are a variety of other agencies, apart from just transit grants, that we could apply for that could help expand your business model, your goals and objectives. So on the grant side, clearly the McAllister team, the Quinn team, and the whole stable of folks, but there'll be a point person, Melissa. We'll work closely with that team to identify where are these innovative opportunities. When you got core business you need to do, you need buses, you need fleet, you need management of those things, you've got all sorts of IT and technologies, you've got intelligent transportation systems you're trying to move on. But we'll try to strategize on where's the money, let's follow the money, because it's really not in earmarks anymore, it's in grants. We'll do that. We'll identify where we can find some matching funds, maybe even some private sector enrollment as well, to really create some, because there's a lot of people in the disruptive technology world, and you're right at the forefront of that. I mean, particularly the Hyperlink program, I think, is very, very important, for sure, you've got others. And then Congressman Boyd will be working on educating members of Congress and staff on some of these initiatives. So you get the information education on the front end, focusing grants for education, and then we'll be working with the scheme and to Mr. Hernandez, who we've been talking to for 6 months on the Hyperlink project, to assist him with identifying your goals, prioritizing where we can, and being here constantly to help pursue those.
And then any collaboration we may do with him on the legislative side on the Hill also, I would like to sit down with him early and identify where those possibilities.
If I could just add, too, with how Melissa works and how our team functions here is we all obviously all work together and figure out where the strengths are that as far as the grant opportunities that we would want to pursue. And then we work with your government relations team in-house to decide jointly, okay, these are the ones that we were going to pursue. And then we figure out in our group who the grant writers are that we're going to bring in. Because we want to have the right grant writers. Obviously, not somebody who's writing healthcare grants or higher education grants, but somebody who's got the right experience. And then we shepherd them through that process and participate from beginning to end in that process. And we don't just throw a grant writer at you. We're working with you internally to get that done.
In looking at your 10-year plan and transportation plan you've had, and the Tampa Bay area, you've got very unique regional partners, lots of different agendas, but there seems to be some real strong coordination at this point, attempts to move forward, and I think we can be very helpful. I mean, I know HART's state lobbyist, I know the folks who are working on these other organizations. In terms of the city of St. Pete, we're here all the time. The ferry is an issue, which is really very, very unique and very innovative. It's not your core business, but it certainly reflects where HART is going in terms of developing a regional intelligent transportation solution. So, I think you're a Madam Director. Just make one little comment. When we were working on the Hyperlink project, it seemed very far-fetched. And was approached by Mr. Hernandez to see if Tesla would be interested. And as I said, there's a perception of public transit company that is X. And then we got on the phone with the East Coast director of Tesla and your director, and we got off, and he says, "Who is that woman?" Mm-hmm. I mean, she is a ball of energy, very visionary, very fiscally responsible, but, you know, really focused. And so really, everybody kind of took this step, kind of trying to make this project work. I think those are the kinds of things that we can help bring to the table. You've got the energy and vision. We've got the expertise, both on the Hill, on the grant writing side, really where the money is, and then trying to find partnerships that will work together to really elevate HART.
Commissioner Brown,
will your office be in Tallahassee or here? Is your office, where is your office?
We're in Washington, D.C.
Oh, okay. Yeah. And you're in Tallahassee?
I'm in Tallahassee.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
Any further questions? Yes, Mr.
As part of your strategy, what do you see the role of the board here and our staff in terms of supplementing your strategy, building relationships, in particular with talking with congressional members on issues and opportunities when they're out of session and here back in the district?
Yeah, it does. It's a pretty critical piece of it because your relationships are really important to this process, particularly in potentially identifying, you know, an undersecretary to try to place now that we have a new administration, or trying to get on advisory committees, federal advisory committees. It's a process you're not involved in now. You know, the Department of Transportation, every federal agency has these advisory committees that represent a cross-section of the market that they represent. And getting somebody who's friendly to the agency on one of those committees when those committees come up for renewal is important. So that's an example of being able to tap local relationships and understanding what your relationships are will be really important. Same with you know, the new Secretary of Transportation coming in, trying to map out and identify where there may be relationships and immediately, particularly relationships for transition teams, because that activity is going to continue even after the inauguration for several months. And so it's important to engage with them. And we have our relationships, but understanding the relationships that are local here will be important.
Can I take a
shot
at that also? That's a quick question. It would be very helpful, obviously, to be working with as many members of the board that would be willing to pitch in. But on the legislative side, in Florida, we have 10 new members of the congressional delegation. 10. We don't know exactly. We don't know yet the committee assignments in the House, how they're going to play out. But we do know that some of the existing members will surely stay in place. You got a congressional member close by the name of Dan Webster in Orlando, who serves on the Transportation Committee. You got a veteran Democratic member down in the South, Lois Frankel, who serves on the Transportation Committee. Peter DeFazio from Oregon is the ranking member. Bill Schuster is the chairman. Those people are probably going to stay in place, we're pretty sure. And so, you know, and helping your help with meeting those new 10 new members, our greatest champions, our greatest allies are going to be from Florida, obviously. So if we do an infrastructure bill, if the Congress and the administration decides to do an infrastructure bill, there will be great opportunities for us to get into that infrastructure bill if we got our act together. So those are the kinds of things that we need to prepare for.
I know you know, I'm sure, I know you all well know your local congressional delegation, Congressman McCasker, Crist, Congressman Ross, Bill Rockus. I mean, we know them all very well. Alan's served with a number of them. We've worked with them pretty, pretty extensively. Obviously, you know, you need them to carry the water, obviously, for the Hillsborough, Tampa Bay area. But we have great relationships with the rest of the congressional delegation around the state, and we can plug it. You know, plug the board members in to the extent that you want to participate and travel to the swamp and be part of that discussion and share the vision that the HART has. And we'll work tirelessly to make that happen for you.
Thank you.
Any further questions? Shannon.
I just want to duly note that you're, at least in our board book, the funding is, you know, $100,000 over the lowest cost. So I just, you know, we do have to be fiscally responsive to our constituency. These are taxpayer dollars, and I don't know if anybody pushed you on that number, but and I don't know if we can. Mr. Burns is shaking his head. Yes, no, yes.
Yeah, no.
That's a big differential from a perspective of trying to consider alternatives?
Yeah, no, we're absolutely can negotiate that and are willing to negotiate that and figure out how to you know, the best way to make that work. So,
the best price guarantee.
Yeah. Duly noted.
Yes.
Study recommends Constable.
As the new members, if you were to get the contract, we're not looking for yes men. We're looking for somebody to tell us what have we been doing right and what have we been doing that perhaps wasn't gaining what we needed. Do you see an immediate action that would change? And I know you're worried about being too polite, as he said, but don't be too polite.
I think the biggest piece is the grant writing expertise and the stable of a 250 grant writers that we have on board. And we've already identified, 15 potential grants that HART certainly would qualify for that would be a starting place. So I think that's the immediate goal. Get your team, your government relations team, with our guys, identify potential places where we can go after those grants and then get to work.
As I'm sure other proposers mentioned, I mean, the world is different in D.C., obviously. With earmarks having gone away 6 years ago, you really can't, you know, come talk to Congressman Boyd, who's on the committee, and say, listen, can you slip something, you know, put something in there for X clients? As much as they'd like to do that, that doesn't exist anymore in that capacity.
And I'm very happy about that.
Absolutely. Yeah. So really, you got to go where, as Willie Lomax said, you got to go where the money is. Really, and the money is really in the state, in these agencies, federal agencies, and you got to have the folks who know. So the team that they have are ex-staffers, former staffers of these agencies who are writing these grants. They know what the requirements are. They know what the focus is. They know where the money is and how to get it. So what we've provided for you on this team here is really this three components of a team where you've got, you know, Congressman Boyd talking to members on the Hill, finding out, you know, this year, next year, where's the trend line going in the big packages, funding packages, regulatory packages. You've got the grants folks saying, we know where these opportunities are going to be. We're going to go write a grant. We'll sit down with you. We're going to write a grant to do X, Y, and Z. Tighter grants are one piece, but there's all sorts of innovative. I know that Cesar Hernandez has looked at this. We've looked at a lot of it. I mean, there's a lot of places that most people wouldn't even look unless you're really got kind of the vision and the profile that you have here with the various transit modes that you're working on, and we'll help with that effort to try to make sure that we're exploring all the partnership options, because that's really, really where this is all going, particularly on the innovative stuff. So I think that's really, to your point, before, maybe they're done in-house, but in this instance, you got a team that's really professional, knows the people, knows where the money is, is going to go after it.
Okay. Thank you very much. I'm sorry.
Can I just further, before we wrap it up, just answer that question a little further? We do, I understand what you're asking as far as, you know, if we think you're going in the wrong direction, we'll tell you. And if, you know, if we think that you're, you know, you have too high hopes for something, we'll definitely tell you, because we want to find your strengths and we want to win them. We want to win those grants, and that's how it works. So we have those hard conversations. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. Appreciate
thank you.
Being here.
Thank you for having us.
Mr. Burns.
Mr. Chair, we have one more firm that wanted to present this morning. They do not have a PowerPoint presentation. It's Potomac Partners or Newman.
Let's move it.
I forgot that. Lowe's Branco. Isn't that what you're kind of?
I know.
Yeah, I serve with Lowe's.
Don't you remember her art in her office?
I remember Lowe's, period.
She used to have, like, the wildest art in her office.
Mm-hmm.
The type of wild. It's like, just wild. I mean, like, it was, like, so...
You have to know Lois.
Yeah, you have to know Lois. And I met her like the first day I was in Tallahassee and I went up to meet her. I know she was chair in some committee. I was going to meet all the members. I didn't know anybody. I liked her. I can imagine Jim's like, you like her art? I'm like, yeah, it was sort of funky. It's like the bright colors. Mm-hmm. So we bonded over that. I forgot she was still in Congress.
To you. Apologize for the fast nature of this presentation. I usually love to talk, but out of respect to your time, we'll keep it short, keep the time. I'm Erica Calde. I'm the founder of Potomac Partners, D.C. I'm from Tampa. I have a place in Clearwater. Moved to Washington, D.C. when my father, Hector, got the job as chief of staff to Sam Gibbons. And got to listen to his lectures about civics every day at the dinner table, so that was my youth. My partner here, Dan Felice, is a U.S. Naval Academy grad. He's a nuclear engineer, was an officer on a nuke sub for many years. Dan then went to the Harvard Kennedy School and got a master's in public policy there. And I'm sure you all know Louis Betts, who's a longtime good friend, and I believe one of the best advocates in this Tampa Bay area. Good man. First, I want to tell you a little bit about our firm's structure, how we're different than others you might see. Talk a little bit about our transportation experience, a few of our relevant successes, and then go into a couple of predictions about 2017. So, after about 10 years of working at large firms and medium-sized firms, I decided to found a boutique-sized firm, a small firm that would limit the number of clients and really stress personal service to the clients. The limited clients for a boutique firm allows the necessary time to spend on each client. Sometimes the bigger firms are going to have so many clients that they don't have that time. As things change, especially with the new administration, that becomes an issue. We also located our office on Capitol Hill. I'm two blocks away from the complex. We did that so we could have a persistent presence. We walk up there and we spend the day on the hill interfacing with the people that are decision makers because things are fluid. Big things can happen quickly. One of the things we like to do is develop very individualized strategies in conjunction with our clients. You're different from our other clients, so we'll look to each of the clients and establish what we believe is a winning strategy based on a backdrop of what the policies are, what the changes are in Washington. We like to think we're very exceptional at creating innovative strategies. When staff up on the Hill sometimes likes to dust off old laws and just ever so slightly change them, we bring in new ideas, and we've been very, very successful in that with our clients. We'll talk more about that in the Q&A. Dan will talk a little bit about that in our successes. One of the things that we've done, and we like to keep it small, but sometimes we will engage a strategic partner when we believe it'll add significant value to how we serve a particular client. In that case, this is why we invited Liz to join us as a strategic partner. They can bring substantial value with his Tampa knowledge and the long-time relationships down here. One of the things that kind of separates us from the rest is we really focus on relationships with chairman, senior staff, and the key policymakers. Chairman write the bills. Their staffs write the bills. You might have a junior member or subcommittee chairman that doesn't know what's in the bill, like this recent highway bill, until the day the bill is put on the dais for debate. So we focus on chairman, and we bring chairman to you. Our clients out in California, I brought 12 different chairmen to Orange County, California, where we represent Orange County Transportation Authority, and that's made a huge difference in their understanding of our clients' needs and appreciation of what it is that the community is about. So it's been very successful. We just got a contract, won the contract for Tampa Airport. They had one of the big firms for about 5 years, and they bid theirs. We won it, and we've already scheduled two chairmen to come down and visit the airport on their two biggest issues. They're going to redo the FAA reauthorization bill this year, and their biggest issue is reimbursement for their explosive detection machines. They're almost $1 billion in the hole for them. So we're going to bring the chairman of that committee, who's already talked to their head of government affairs. Funding, as it relates to funding, you should focus, in our opinion, on Congress, because most of the policy and funding decisions are driven by Congress. And the administration, you know, there's a grant process, but a lot of it's done in a black box, and there's only limited things that an advocate can do for you. I mean, the decisions are made, there's the administration, so you've got to really focus on pushing them through Congress. A little bit into some of our experiences. I personally have had 25 years as an advocate on Capitol Hill. As I said, I'm an attorney. Our transportation experience is relevant to you. We represent probably the most successful transit agency in the country, OCTA. They are very innovative. They've gotten a lot of things done. They've really broken the mold on a lot of things. Dan will talk to you a little bit about some of those things. But OCTA has the most successful toll road in America. They have variable pricing, and it's so successful that it pays for many of their other priority projects. Expressway 91, I've had three different chairmen sitting there in the control room of their expressway authorities outfit. We just got a light rail, New Start, approved and secured a bunch of funding for it in this appropriations process, which was a big thing for a rather conservative area. You know, a lot of grants have been generally perceived as political, and Orange County is known to be a rather red area. We've also been very engaged in their transportation ballot measures. They've had two successful transportation ballot measures, and they really had a tactic in a community that's very much against tax increases. But they made very specific promises to their constituents and twice have now passed it. We helped them, you know, secure what was doable on their list of promised projects. In bus discretionary funding, in this last bill, there's the kind of tug of war between the big guys, the big systems, and the medium to small systems. And we helped, you know, win the case for more money going to the medium to small systems because, you know, that issue of state of good repair is always out there for the big guys. They want to swallow up as much of the money. And we had some success working with Bill Schuster, the chairman, who is a longtime good friend. I actually learned the business traveling with his father. Another one of our clients is MetroLink, heavy rail, commuter rail that serves 5 counties and over 20 million people in Southern California. It has L.A. County, Orange, San Bernardino, Riverside, and Ventura. Successes we've had there with those guys is they you probably heard of their Chatsworth accident where over 100 people were killed. They implemented PTC as a congressional, the two senators passed a positive train control rule, which is a safety technology that APTA was against, and all the, you know, the class one rails were against. And we convinced Congress that it's necessary, and it's now passed, and it's now in operation for them out there. We also got them some RIF grants and RIF policy changes so that certain things that they do qualify for funding in a non-earmark area. So we felt very good about that. They have Tier 4 locomotives, which are clean locomotives. They run with almost 80% more power, and they have about 10% to 15% of the emissions of the old locomotives. They're remarkable. You know, they have their smog problems up there. And then we started to make the case for quiet zone. Got there with the ports of L.A. Long Beach. The trains were running, and, you know, they've got to blow their horns at grade crossings and wake people up in the middle of the night so you can get quiet zones if you fortify your, so quiet zones is a new policy that we have taken to Washington very, very successfully. I'm going to let Dan talk to you about some of our successes.
Sure, thank you, Rick. Appreciate it. Appreciate your time. As Rick said, in consideration of your time, I'll just sort of run through a list here, spare you some of the war stories and strategy and tactics, Emily. But most of these successes focus around funding. I know that's a very important aspect of what you guys are looking for and what we need to get done for you. First, secured the largest earmark in the Safety Lou Surface Transportation Authorization for the Maglev Deployment Program. That was $90 million. We're experts in securing funding like that, whether it's bus programs, rail, road programs, and all varieties of transportation funding. We've also had some policy success. I think we touched on it earlier with Orange County Transportation Authority. They were came up with some very innovative ideas to streamline the environmental process, the NEPA process, came out with an initiative, Breaking Down Barriers, that was subsequently translated to legislative language, introduced as a bill, but then later incorporated into MAP 21. It actually became the cornerstone of the bill, a major selling point with the Republicans in the House. You know, again, I touch back on what Rick was talking about with the state of good repair battles with regard to the large and small and medium-sized transit agencies, and really going in and making a case for the bus discretionary funding, which hopefully going forward here in this first cycle will start to balance the scales. You know, another innovative policy that we've been at the forefront is developing the workarounds for this earmark moratorium. I'm sure you've heard some about this. Congress, in its infinite wisdom, has decided that they want to relegate all that spending prerogative to the administrative agencies. But we still can find ways to work around that, working with, as Rick said, the chairman, to make sure that as they look at these programs, there's criteria that can have preferences for the most efficient operators. This is something that we do very well and has resulted in some great funding success, again, for our clients. You know, finally, I'll just touch on another policy success is working with OCTA on one of the largest intermodal centers out in the West Coast in Anaheim. A lot of that had to do with the policy as well, making sure that those intermodal centers were included in a lot of the different funding streams that are available at DOT. As a consequence, they've secured upwards of $30 to $40 million over the last several years. So I just, you know, one thing I'll reemphasize that Rick said, a lot of these successes, the cornerstone is working with the chairman, the key policymakers, bringing them out, letting them see what they're supporting and funding, and something we're really looking forward to doing here.
For me, I kind of have a selfish desire here because I'm from here. I'm going to retire here. I have a house out at the beach. And I've sat in some of your traffic jams, and I didn't like them, and I want to help fix them. This client that we represent, probably the single worst road in America, is the 405. You can clearly tell when you've left Los Angeles County and gotten to Orange County because they do things right. They're very innovative. They're very smart with what they do. and we've had a really good program with them. A dozen years ago when we started with them, we were one of four entities that represented them. Today, we're the only firm that still represents them, and it's a good partnership. We've done some good things on the West Coast. At one time I worked for my father's firm. I'm sure some of you might know him and that firm. And when I was there, I ran the Hillsborough County client team, and then for a short time the Tampa client team. We got some of the original funding for the streetcar under Mayor Greco, which he loved. So, and he was a passionate guy, and he really came to Washington. People loved him. I credit him with getting some of that initial funding. But it's a partnership. You know, the beauty of our group is we'll limit ourselves. We don't have 200 clients, and we will work with you. We'll learn about you. We know a lot about you now, but we will learn a lot more about you should we be successful in this contract. But and we want to create personal relationships with you and our chairman friends. The first six times Bill Schuster ever went to California, he asked me to take him and teach him about the transportation structure in Southern California. Before he was the chairman, now that he's the chairman, you know, they have HART lunch with him. That makes a difference. Your delegation is a good delegation, but you know, right now, none of them are well positioned on the committees to help you. So that limits their abilities. So you should be working with this one. As far as predictions, Trump's making a lot of promises. There's Trump trillions out there, and nobody still knows what it is. You know, late last week, we're sitting down with senior staff on the Transportation Committee, and they don't know. Elaine Chao was a good pick because she spent some time at DOT. She's a good CEO type, and I think she'll work very collaboratively with Congress. Schuster's a, you know, he's a strong player. You'll see a lot of P3. I think Trump is going to try to bring the private sector in, and we've done a lot of P3 around the country. We know it well. Then you'll see probably some limited earmarks come back. And that's good because Mario Diaz-Balart is a dear friend, and you know, he's done a lot for our clients. So, as far as grants, how they change, maybe they get less political. They were very political under this current administration. Maybe they get less political and more meritorious. There's so much an advocate can do for you. These decisions, again, are made in a black box. You know, the only real thing is, you know, the two piles of paper they get, the grant applications with a lot of political support and those with none. You know, we'll get you a lot of political support. We'll look at things with you and help you create the best grant applications you can. But you know, anybody that's promising you we'll get you a grant is over-promising. That's largely what we are. Small boutique. You're looking at the people that'll be working for you. It's not going to be anybody else. And it'll be us. And we're 24/7 guys. You call me at midnight if you want to ask a question. And I'll usually answer the phone. So, thank you for your time and happy to take any questions.
Are there any questions? Any questions? Yes, sir.
Yeah. Do you have any experience helping agencies write grants? Or are you, I mean, is there any technical experience as far as grant writing? Any history of that?
I have sat at the table on teams that have designed grants. I'm not a grant writer. You know, usually the folks that we work, like for instance OCTA, they got fantastic in-house people that'll write things, but they'll also secure, you know, some real specific experts in an area where it might be a different sort of grant. But what we do in the process is we'll sit there with those that are writing it. We'll say, here are the realities, here are the players, here's what you need to say, here's what you need to be careful with. And, you know, for instance, like the ballot measures, when you're a self-help community, that gives you a big leg up. When you have regional agreement on things. That gives you another diplomat. But I know in this area, you know, Pinellas is sometimes like a foreign country. And you know, where you can get consensus. When I was a young man, I was a young lobbyist, I took the current chairman, Bill Schuster's then chairman father, Bud Schuster, to Las Vegas. And in Las Vegas and Clark County, you go outside there, you're in desert for you know, miles and miles and miles. And they had three competing concepts for one system. And then he sat in there and listened to them all, and that was back in the time of New Germans. And Bud says, you know what, I really want to help you, and I really like these projects, but I'm going to give you a piece of advice. You come to me with three different projects, and you're going to get nothing. I'm not going to referee. I'm going to fund those people that have consensus in their community on what they want and what they need. So another reason OCTH is so successful. They're a county of over 3 million people, and they work the entire county's transportation issues. They get consensus at their board meetings, and then they take their plans to Washington. But as it relates to the grants, yes, we can help that process. Okay.
And do you have any experience with Small Starts grants?
The one that we just got secured in Orange County is one. So, and Santa Ana Street Park, so we work with that. But they'll also, again, they secured some real, you know, noteworthy experts that did grant writing that were, you know, helping them. Not a lot of people do it under one roof. Well,
And you know, just to follow on to that point, you know, a lot of what the input that we bring to the table, again, is that inside the Beltway understanding of how the trends are moving, especially with regard to some of these transit and small start programs. Ridership is very important, but they also were talking a lot about economic development. Those were sort of informal grading criteria that you wouldn't read in the initial publications that came out, but us having that ability to understand and get that intel back to the grant writers and work with them to structure it, I think in the end, bore out a lot of success.
And that's actually a good point. With the new administration, do you see the criteria for all the different grants changing?
Yes.
You know, the
yes.
focus on, you know, land use, right? Cost effectiveness, things like that.
Yes, ma'am. You know, Trump is a guy that, you know, Florida is very important to. And you know, you're going to have a Senate race that could be interesting and could create some very favorable dynamics if you know how to surf them. Great. Bill Nelson is on a good committee. He's not on the right committee, but he's on a good committee. Richard Shelby, who is a, you know, a longtime old friend that I learned a couple of hard lessons from and a lot of good lessons from. Firm I was at before his former chief staff founded and got to know the inner workings of Shelbyland. And as the chairman of banking, he's very involved. He'll probably next session of Congress become the chairman of appropriations. He'll rotate to that.
Yes.
Someone else is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for a great presentation. Appreciate it. Just had a quick question, and noting it's on the public record. You did, you know, score well in our evaluation, and I'm curious because we didn't have the liberty of a PowerPoint, we didn't get to see as kind of maybe as much as many of the elements of your firm.
Yeah.
I'm very impressed with the three of you standing here, and but from a depth standpoint and staff support. I'm looking at our scope of services and our kind of our list, and it's a pretty big list that we need to, you know, that need to be provided. Can you tell me a little bit more about just the support you have, you know, and things like that?
We have another young man that works for us. It's a Gator grad, which is unfortunate because I'm a Seminole.
Sorry.
I like you. Lewis has a staff guy that works with him on a daily basis. But it's important that we read and we know what's going on. And not, you know, Dan is, you know, his hall is about, his office is right down the hall from me, and I think he hears almost every conversation I have and vice versa, but that's important. Your scope of services is something that we're very much used to, you know, for our client out in California, even longer. But we're used to them, we operate them, and some things will become priorities at different times. You watch what's happening, trends on the hill, and then you also work together to create the potential for innovative strategies that you might have that will separate yourselves from the others. Like, we're not going to represent too many transportation authorities because then we're in there asking the same people for too many different things, and that confuses people. So very comfortable with the scope, but it's us. It's us. And I'll be talking to him probably more than I ever have because, you know, he knows the local pulse. And I think it's important for you to know the local pulse. While, you know, I'm from Tampa, and I come down here a lot, not enough, but it's important to me to know the local pulse in addition to talking to you, your staff, and everybody. We have family relationships with our clients, and we keep them for a very long time. I would suggest to talk to Joe Lapano, who I've known for a short time, who will already sing our praises because of the level of service we've already provided. He's ecstatic about getting me Chairman Mike McCall, who controls the money on explosive detection. He's going to meet Chairman Liviando in New Jersey, who's writing the FAA reauthorization bill, with Bill Schuster. They're coming here. So I'd like to bring people here to you. And I'll promise you I can get Bill Schuster here to meet you, here to see your operation, and here to understand what it is you're looking for. He loves to create things and to create success. When he was railroad subcommittee chairman, he would sit on the dais during hearings and he would quote verbatim our client statistics for the Losan Corridor, the second most heavily traveled, heavy rail, passenger rail corridor in America. And he's quoting their statistics for his own purposes. So our clients got what they needed.
Great. Thank you.
Okay.
Appreciate it.
Well, thank you very much, sir.
Thank you for your patience, Mr. Chair, as you sat through all three presentations.
Yes, Mr.
First off, Al, I want to say thank you for bringing them all three in. At first, I was opposed to bringing all three in because of the ratings, and I just looked at the sheer ratings and all. I was happy to hear all three present, to be frankly honest with you. While they were presenting, I was also looking through that list of requirements I had there. And it might just be me and my naive ear, but it seemed to me we had various different approaches to this. I saw one came heavy on the legislative side, and I saw one come heavy on the grant side. And as in reading through our requirements, in our requirements, grants were only mentioned once, I believe. Federal funding was mentioned quite a bit of times. So as I looked at all three of them, and I'm happy that the last one came up when they did without a presentation and just spoke to us more or less. I think we, you know, we may or may not have already voted on this. I turn to David and ask that question. But there's some additional thought, I think, that we need to place on this as opposed to just awarding based on the overall merit score. And I don't know if anybody else thinks in that way.
I certainly support that point of view.
Well, before we move forward, I think Mr. Burrs is going to say something. Yeah. Were you going to say something, Mr. Burrs, then we come back to discuss?
At committee, what staff recommended was that we bring all three offers in front of you to present. We did not make normally when I come up or staff comes up with the action item, staff brings along with that action item a recommendation to award a contract to contractor X or a contractor A. This is a board procurement, so I'll defer, as you said, to David, but staff did not bring a recommendation other than to present.
Can I ask a clarifying question on that?
Yes.
Did you not bring a recommendation because that's protocol, or did you not bring a recommendation because you felt all three were qualified and wanted to leave that decision to the board?
In committee, there was an intense discussion on this, whether or not we should go with the parent number one ranked firm, or should we bring all three offerors in. I encouraged, in my recommendation to the committee, was to bring all three offerors in, given the competitive range that we saw, and the committee voted yes on that.
So there could have been a circumstance where you had a recommendation, but you chose not to do that here.
But state and federal legislative lobbyists or consulting services is a board item. So I don't believe last time we brought it before the board that I brought a recommendation for that. It's something that the board votes on directly.
So I guess I'll ask this question. The question I'm actually trying to ask, do you guys have a favorite or a recommendation, and will we hear that before we...
Staff does not have a favorite. We don't do that. What we have is we have the ranking from the evaluation committee members.
Let me let Ms. Egan comment on that. If you look at the sheet here, they just gave rankings. At the beginning, he said there was no staff recommendation. Outset, he said it. So the staff has not performed any rankings or recommendations. They just did the rankings.
Okay.
I think Ms. Egan wants to say something.
Yes, sir. Director Carino, historically, for the legislative contracts and for legal services contracts, the board has preferred that staff do the work of evaluating the offers, going through the price evaluation, and doing that to keep that process clean, but then bring all of that to the board's consideration. So at least in my tenure and in the few years before that, staff has not recommended a legislative firm or a legal services firm. Now, staff, if in going through something a firm is unresponsive, the price is completely out of whack, the firm is just not hitting it on the technical evaluations, and we will flag that as not responsive. But
Mr. Chairman,
the direction of the board, we have not provided recommendations.
If I might also provide some guidance to the board, given the nature of the procurement, much like a legal procurement, you have some very unique aspects you have to evaluate. The issue under your RFP, I believe you could recommend any of the three, because you are going to decide who is the first group to initiate negotiations with. The prices are the prices they have proposed, but not necessarily the prices the staff would bring them to you with a recommendation. If you should choose A, B, or C, and negotiations with C do not succeed, then we would go to the next one in line. So you really need to determine who the first is, the second is, and we'll go in that fashion. But the critical factor legally is you may choose any one of these who, in your opinion, represents the best interests of the agency. So you don't have the normal limited financial analysis. You've got also the unique circumstances associated with your expertise.
So your recommendation is that we have two firms. One is our top and another one is a backup.
I would recommend you do that because it also gives you leverage in your negotiations with whoever you pick first.
Okay. Commissioner Murphy, you recognize.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And I want to thank the work of you, Al Burns, and the committee. You had a really good committee that kind of looked over this whole, they heard all these presentations too, just so you all know. So they, we got to hear what they heard, but they didn't.
They didn't.
How did they score then?
Each firm submitted a proposal.
Oh, so they scored the proposals. I see. Okay. So I have some comments, and, I think that the thing that always ranks the highest with me is the total technical score and who really – that's the nitty-gritty of your proposal that I think means the most to an organization. I saw some very big differences between them, and of course, as someone who sat and heard many proposals come before us, you kind of get a sense for who you know, you can read between the lines of who has meat on the bones and who doesn't. And I think with that in mind, I am going to recommend the approval of Holland and Knight as the vendor that we will select for government relations, and authorize the chief executive officer to enter in negotiations and to award an 18-month contract with 2-year options, 2 1-year options for federal legislative consulting services to Holland and Knight. And that is my motion for 5 reasons. Number 1, they're contacts. 2, they are locally based. They are at our fingertips at any time. They have a long history with HART. They know our organization. They know what Catherine Egan is thinking day in and day out. They know what our aspirations are. They know how this community is moving in terms of transportation. And so I don't think that there is a whole lot to get up to speed on. Their depth of knowledge of direction for transit, not just in this community, but for HART, I think probably was technically really to their advantage over all the other two. Their proven past successes for us, I think, have been key, especially in terms of grants, different things. So that is my motion. Those are my reasons for making that motion, and we'll move forward.
Would you please restate your motion?
I recommend that we approve Holland and Knight as the federal legislative consulting firm for us, and that we authorize our chief executive officer to enter in negotiations with Holland and Knight, award the 18-month contract with 2-year, 1-year options for federal legislative consulting services to Holland and Knight.
Okay, that's a motion by Commissioner Merman,
second by Commissioner Shanahan.
Before I call on Mr. Roach, Mr. Roach has next in line. Our attorney recommended 2. We only recommended 1.
Oh, okay. Then, I'm sorry, I forgot that. Then the second would be McAllister and Quinn as the backup.
So you add that to your motion?
I will add that to my motion.
Okay. Mr. Roach, you recognize?
Yeah, boy, tough decision. and I would conclude like you did. I think my top two firms would be Holland and Knight and McAllister. Some of the things that I was looking for that I heard more from McAllister, however, they used the word a lot on automated vehicles. They talked about innovations more. They talked about experience with P3 infrastructure. They talked about, on one of their slides, even though earmarks could come back, they seem to have a lot of technical, not that Holland and Knight doesn't, but I think given their size is actually an advantage, because it seemed like one was too big, one was too little, and one was just right and kind of in the middle, both in terms of staff and in terms of technical abilities. So, I think that I liked also in their slides, going through their slides, I don't know that I heard it in their presentation, but McAllister had talked about building a roadmap coming down in the first 20 days. And so from a strategic perspective, I think they may have some fresh new ideas. The fact that they haven't been our lobbyists for years could be an advantage as well. I would throw it out there if you, you know, and I'd like to hear the other board input, but I might be open to maybe seeing if we could amend it to maybe change the order of the two. But would look for further discussion before I go that way.
Okay. Commissioner White, you recognize.
Thank you. I no longer need the floor for my initial thought, but since this was just posed, I'll just say that I'm supportive of the order that Commissioner Merman's proposed.
Mr. Suarez, you're next.
Thank you. There's a couple things. One, I agree with, I'm going to support the motion from Commissioner Merman, and I agree with what Director Giroux said concerning what they had, except for one thing. They didn't get into enough detail as to who was going to actually be doing the work. You know, saying I have 250 grant writers, I don't know if you've ever watched the movie The Grifters, and the guy says, I've got all these people back here doing all this work. It's like, well, who are they? You know, so that was the only thing that gave me a little bit of pause. I thought they made a very good presentation. I think that they are, and I think that all of these groups that are going to be presenting now under a new administration really aren't sure where everything's going to go. And I think no matter what happens in terms of going forward, this board and this leadership is the one that's going to drive that innovation. And I think that we've already shown that. I think with Catherine Egan and the rest of us, we've done a great job of doing that. And I think that we're going to target, I think, be more innovative than we've ever been, because I think we're going to have that opportunity because of the way, hopefully, the rules will change a little bit to allow agencies our size to have the kind of advantage that we haven't had in the past. So I'm going to support the Holland and Knight group as number one. I agree with Commissioner Merman that McAllister and Quinn would be number two. And I wish that they had put a little bit more meat on the bone, so to speak, as you were mentioning, so that we knew exactly what they were going to do in terms of those folks. It may have changed my mind, but I do like both firms, and I think that Holland Knight's the one that won the day, though. Thank you, sir.
Shanahan, you're recognized.
I support the motion on the floor, and I just would caution my fellow members, when you have a procurement process and you have a committee that's selected and they go through a thorough evaluation of a proposal that I'm sure is much longer than the 5 or 7 or 10 slides we saw here today, you should really respect the process. Mm-hmm. Be very careful about circumventing a procurement process, because there are all sorts of vulnerabilities. And when I look at, I think their presentation today was enough to give them some consideration, but they were 30% off on technical score, 20% off on price, 30% off on total. I mean, those are substantive numbers. 5%, maybe I'd give them a look. From a go-forward perspective, we have a process, we have a head of procurement. You get into nothing but trouble when you have a 10-minute presentation and you start second-guessing it. So I say that for the record for I don't know how long I'll be serving on this board, but I got to tell you, this is very scary when people start readdressing the recommendations of the committees, when you have a very thorough process led by a exemplary professional. That's my statement.
Linda is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I just want to note, I'd like to acknowledge Director Shanahan's comments just now. I would agree. And I definitely respect the procurement process. And it is impressive that Holland and I did so well, both on the technical score and the price. And I certainly respect that, and I support the motion. I just wanted to make a couple of footnotes. I did find it interesting that Potomac scored second technically, and then there were really, so McAllister on the technical side, was not in the in that, didn't score quite as well. However, I think having the opportunity to have all three firms present, each one was impressive in their own right. I really think that. But that's why I brought up the scope. I think when I look at this, are the tasks that staff has compiled, and it's impressive. I think it's very in-depth and robust. I think that Holland and Knight is the best equipped. They know us. And I think the elephant in the room is the uncertainty of, the Trump with the genie hat on and the one slide. No one can predict that, but I think that Holland and I gives us the most resources to deal with any uncertainty. So, thank you.
Mr. Quinnell.
So, Ms. Shanahan, just to clarify, you're recommending not to support the motion. You're recommending to vote for number one and number two.
Well, I'll support the motion on the floor, but I think it's very scary to change a procurement process.
What would cause you to support the motion on the floor if, in fact, you wanted to follow the procurement process? Because I heard presentations, and I understand, and I guess I'd like to ask staff, did you meet with these folks, hear the presentations? I always go back to kind of what's the one thing, what's the single most important thing these people can do for us? Did you go through that, or was it a very technical evaluation? Did you meet with them? Did you try to get a feel for, you know, their objectives, the way they went about trying to achieve what we wanted to achieve, or was it more of a technical?
It was more of a technical sample.
Let me say, having been in the procurement process, I think what staff did, they didn't meet with them. The RFPs were sealed when they came in, and I'm quite sure there were others. They went through all the RFPs, they reviewed them and rated them, and their recommendations came out as 1, 2, 3. One being McAllister Knight, 2 being Potomac Partners, 3 being McAllister Quinn. They didn't make any recommendations, and in most cases, staff won't make a recommendation to other boards that I've been in. They make the they just rate them, and we were the ones that make the recommendations of what we want to do. They didn't talk to them. This is probably the first time they've heard anything from these.
So I think we understand the process, right? The debate here is really one of, okay, we have technical evaluation, and then we have a presentation where there was, I think, very significant messaging, different messaging on the part of each one of the three.
Right.
And I think what I'm trying to do is understand, you know, in particular, based on the folks who spent more time, how much weight we should put on the presentation and the specific messaging that we heard today versus how much weight we should put on the technical ranking. And that's the challenge that I'm having in my mind. Because I had a very different ranking when I listened to the one thing, what their objectives were. Holland and Knight, we have great reach. We know a lot of people, right? Potomac Partners, we're going to go after the one thing. We're going to help you strategically go after the big things. McAllister, we're going to throw a whole bunch of grants against the wall and get a lot of money for you guys. And it's very nonspecific, at least is what I heard, what they chose to focus on and present. And to me, barring staff's analysis telling us that we shouldn't pick one of these, I think we need to examine the messaging that each one of these brought forth in terms of what they want to do for us, because I think we need to decide what our primary objectives are to this lobbying. So I understand what I'm really trying to do is evoke a little bit of feedback on the qualitative side of things from staff who spent a lot of time meeting with them, and of course Mr. Hernandez, who's going to have to be working with them. I've been unsuccessful, and maybe my questions are inappropriate in this context, but that's really what I've been trying to do is evoke just some sort of qualitative reaction from staff about these firms other than the pure tech.
Mr. Chairman, if I could address that a little bit, try to be a little clearer. No two procurements are alike. And different kinds of procurements require a different amount of board flexibility. Having been involved in lawsuits and bid protests and challenges, I know what you need to do to make it legal. I tried to provide you the bare minimum of that at the outset by saying it better be in the best interest of the agency. In a unique situation such as a procurement of someone who operates as your lobbyist, as someone who operates as your general counsel, your unique specific understanding is relevant to that decision. It's much more important from my perspective that this board is comfortable with who they hire as a lobbyist. That is not a decision you delegate to staff. It's not a decision that's geared based on an ITB approach, which where you have the clear specs and someone bids and price governs, and there's case law that says you better give it to the lowest bidder. This is a different situation. Much like Ms. Shanahan said, nothing makes a lawyer happier than have you do exactly what staff recommends. But I want to make sure you understand you have a little bit more flexibility in this situation, which is why it was brought to you in this fashion.
Ms. Egan.
And Director Carino, a point to note, what you have in your packet is essentially what the lobbyists were evaluated on for their scoring mechanism. So you end up with a score of the proposal which came closest to that. I'll defer to Mr. Burns' information on this. We have a robust pre-bid program. The window for these solicitations is out for quite a while. We have a lot of attendance to our conferences before the bids are received. So there's a lot of opportunities for an offering firm to determine how they want to approach, how they want to bid, how they want to message. If Mr. Hernandez has anything more he'd like to add on, and I'm not seeing the nodding or the shaking of the head, but there you go. Slowly, I see. But for the technical side, for the things which your staff had identified were the most pressing concerns to evaluate, this is what the firms were scored against, and this is what you have in front of you. If there's anything you'd like to add, Susan.
And I guess I would just like to add that we did have a very robust discussion at the Strategic Planning Committee. And one of the things that came out of that discussion is to be more inclusive with the entire board so that we can get their reflections as to what the firms were presenting. Now, we graded technical things, but as you can see, when you work in legislative affairs, there are some things that can't be quantified. And that's why there's a lot of experience on this board, a lot of former legislators, as well as private citizens who have been engaged as far as the proximity of the political process. So we felt that it would be value, it would have a strong sense of value to bring them before you, and that's why they were here. Now I'd like to highlight some biases of mine. I've only worked with one firm, I've been here for a year. We've been effective this year as far as maximizing the resources we've been able to bring home. Another one of the firms, I've been working with them as far as some of the private relationships with Tesla. So that's kind of the reason why I've removed myself from a lot of the discussions, because as a human being, I'm going to have biases working with individuals. So with that being said, we want to be fair. We wanted the entire board to engage as far as what this process looks like. And that's what we did here today. So we're looking for the board to make that decision as far as how we can move forward, because we have an opportunity to create the most maximize our team in D.C. We've changed the game, the way we've done things at HART. It's no longer where our federal team is strictly federal, our state team is strictly state. We have run vanguard efforts in some of our objectives this past year as how we look at both teams and where they have relationships so that we can meet our strategic objectives. So with that being said, that's why we thought this would be the best route.
Mr. McClain, you recognize.
I just want to state that my comments at the very beginning of this was just to stir conversation. We were brought three very good candidates, what I would assume. I do understand the procurement process, and I don't find this scary. This is the reason we're here. They brought three candidates for us to look at, for us to discuss with, and for us to choose one of those three. And I think that's what we're doing. We're going through the process right here. Exactly what Caesar just mentioned. He has some biases. They had ample discussion themselves. And so I thought this was a good place to do that discussion. Now, with that said, I, too, agree with Commissioner Merman's recommendation, and I will go forward with that. But this is what we're here for. This is not scary. This is what we're here for.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Jacob, recognize.
Yeah, briefly on that, and being in an industry that relies on public procurement, a lot, going through these an awful lot. I understand exactly what Ms. Shanahan is pointing to. However, in this case, I think it's a little different only because from the technical standpoint, I think it was very helpful what you went through, and thank you again for that, by the way. I thought it was wonderful what you did and brought to us. However, I look at this as in what's coming up for us and the decisions we need to make and the things we're going to do here, who do I want to stand beside out there getting this done? And that's why I think these presentations were so great today for us to stand there. Who do we want to stand next to and out there lobbying and pushing our agenda forward to make it better for our community? And I think that's what I'm looking at this point in time on who I would support, and I agree with Commissioner Merman on your assessment of a baseline.
Seeing no further discussion, we have a motion by Commissioner Merman, second by Commissioner Shanahan, to authorize the Chief Executive Officer to enter into negotiations and award an 18-month contract with two your options for federal legislative consulting services, with Holland & Knight being number one and McAllister & Quinn LLC being number two. Seeing no further discussion, all those in favor of the motion, let me know by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, likewise. Motion is adopted. Okay. Next, we move into the chairman's report. So you're new here, I don't have a report yet.
you can report on my report.
I will say this, though, that I will have the committees that I have to appoint, we'll do that as soon as I possibly can. And we're probably going to look at an ad hoc committee to look at our CEO's evaluation and keep her here. But I mean, I'm just going to say keep her here. Go from there. So that's my report. Executive Director report.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Briefly, in the interest of time, at the Legislative Committee meeting in December, the committee voted to adopt the state legislative priorities. We did not have a recommendation in the minutes to bring the priorities to the full board for your consideration, so you do have the priorities in front of you today. In speaking to General Counsel, I understand it is appropriate to entertain a motion from the floor for this board to adopt these as the board's legislative priorities for this calendar year for 2017.
Very much.
Thank you. We did at the committee.
Yes,
we did adopt this priority list, so
yes, ma'am.
It is a recommendation of the committee, this list, and I'll move approval.
Second. Motion by Commissioner Merman, second by a host of folks, to adopt the 2017 top state legislative priorities. Seeing no further discussion, all those in favor, let it be known, saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, likewise, motion is adopted.
Also, in the interest of time, the regional premium transit plan, going with the term plan now, we had committed to bringing monthly updates to the board, and we will go ahead and convey more information in writing. Just looking at the clock, we do want to make sure that we update the board where we are and the information going on. Marco, can we update within 60 seconds?
Yes. Promise. Keep it really brief. You all know, good morning, board. You all know that that the contract to Jacobs was awarded for this plan back in September. Notice to proceed, move forward in late October. The work is underway. We're pretty close to having the situational appraisal done. Next steps is it's really important to have engagement as one region through this work effort. And in doing that, the website will be very important for communication to make sure that everyone is involved and gets the same information. We're very transparent. The website will be launched early next month. We've engaged as a group, the regional business partners through the Tampa Bay Partnership. It's an important way in which we're engaging as a region in the work effort. The Tampa Bay TMA, the Transportation Management Area, which has membership from the three MPOs, Pasco, Pinellas, and Hillsborough, is an important advisory group on a regional basis as part of this effort. And then the third group that we wanted to share with you that Jacobs has recommended we convene is a transit coalition group, which would be made up of the executive committees of HART and PSTA, and appointees from the Pasco County Commission. And that would serve as kind of a decision-making body, again, called the Transit Coalition, that would help to approve major recommendations at major milestones as the work effort moves forward. So we wanted to kind of float that idea with the HART Board today. We think this is an important way for us to make sure that we're working together as one region, with HART playing an important role as the administrator of the study, but being very mindful of the importance of working as three counties together and moving forward with the work effort.
And to clarify, we would tie these meetings to the existing executive committee meetings. And previously, this board has indicated a desire to see us meeting quarterly with our Pinellas Executive Committee meetings, so we would roll this together. So it's not an additional meeting on the calendar. It would be an update at a duly constituted body, a meeting of the Executive Committee.
We foresee that it would be approximately a total of six meetings. It would really be three additional meetings in addition to those quarterly meetings that are part of MPSDA. We would just have an additional meeting every other month that would also include Pasco as part of this transit coalition.
So we'll receive recommendations back from the board and in through our committees. Thank you, Marco. That was probably 60 seconds. HART was honored on December 15th with recognition by the Environmental Protection Commission in Hillsborough County. Wanted to share this briefly. So good job. Excellent work to staff. The work that we are doing is not unnoticed. And regardless of how you appreciate it, whether you want to save the planet or save money, the less we consume is the less that we have to spend. So thank you to Jeff and your team for making sure that we've carved this out, not just as a responsive to the community, but being good stewards of public funds as we're looking at our environmental stewardship. And then finally, late last week, you received an email summarizing proposed interlocal agreements between HART and Pinellas. We brought a draft agreement to the HART Legislative Committee on December 19th. We have received feedback from that. That was in the body of your email. Our friends in Pinellas adopted a draft memo of understanding, very similar, last Wednesday to forward up to a board workshop, which they are holding later this week. We'll have staff in attendance. So that is in your inbox for your review. The guidance from our Legislative Committee
was to forward this information to the full board and then discuss this in a January 23rd Legislative and Strategic Planning Committee meeting, which we will have. A point I would like to stress is when we are talking regionally, and Ms. Calvert hit good points earlier today, on, you know, regional MPOs, what is the drive, what are the conversations? HART is acting as a regional implementing body. We began this with the regional fare card. We are doing this with this regional premium transit plan. We can do amazing things for Hillsborough County and our region. We will do autonomous vehicles. We will be looking to expand Hyperlink. But these programs are not just unique or germane to Tampa or to Hillsborough County. They have reach and they have effectiveness because they are regional in nature. And when we speak to our decision makers, they are asking us where we are looking regionally. So I'd offer up as we go through this process and evaluating these documents, we are in a regional operating role, and it is a good time for the board to clarify what this means for you as a policy going forward. But if we are not in this regional conversation, it will go to another body, and HART will be stuck with somebody else's decisions if we allow that to happen in that way. I'm really biased. I think we have a great staff. I would put us toe-to-toe anywhere in the country. We're ready for the challenge, and we have shown that. Let us lead. And that concludes my comments on that.
You done?
Yes, sir.
Thank you very much. Mr. Smith.
Yes, I would like to be as brief as I can, but I don't want to give short shrift to this very important issue, which is the CEO evaluation. As you know, we're obligated by our contract with the CEO to provide an annual evaluation. You went through that process. The board was extremely diligent. I looked at the materials. You guys obviously take this as seriously as it is. We have the evaluation summarized for you in your materials. In order to get to the action points, however, I also want to point out the fact that her contract is due to expire May of 2017. We have the ability to extend it as is or to change that contract. It's not something you need to decide today, because I know this board has had discussions about changing some of the KPIs and some other aspects of the contract. But I want to at least get that on your radar screen, because it is something we need to address in short order. What we do need to do today, however, is we need to assimilate the evaluations that have been provided by all the board members, and we need to decide what action you want to take in that regard. Specifically, that would be what merit increase is appropriate for Ms. Egan. Again, if you do not want to do that today because you feel like you don't have enough time to deliberate adequately, we can postpone that. But what the contract requires is, or allows, is that based upon the KPI performances alone, you may provide an increase that's commensurate with the non-union employees. That is in your materials. It's 1.5% in salary and 3.5% in bonus. And in addition to that, you have other factors you can consider, subjective evaluations with regard to the performance by the CEO, and yet another third characteristic could be market considerations, et cetera. So that, I'm providing you the context. The immediate issue in front of you today, however, would be that, consistent with the contract, she's eligible for an increase in compensation of up to 1.5% in her compensation and 3.5% for her bonus. I believe I've got those numbers correct. Yes, they're on page 4.3 of your materials. That's a quick summary. Again, I don't mean to give this short shrift, so if there are any questions, I'd be happy to try to answer more or elaborate.
Before you do that, I said something on our ad hoc committee, but I didn't know you were going to bring this up. I should have looked at the agenda. So I hear what you're saying, that we could do this today. And I'm going to yield the floor to members to see if they want to do this today, as far as extending a contract, number one, and the possibility of increase in salary compensation today. And then we won't need to do the ad hoc committee if that's the pleasure of this body. So I'm going to call on Mr. Roach first.
Yeah, well, I had kind of a question. I'm not sure that this number is available or not, but I'm looking at the KPIs, and under finance, it says to be reported, and that had to do with whether or not we grew our fund balance or if we had to dip into reserves. And so do we? When will we? It says that it's to be reported at year's end.
Thank you, Director Jaroche. This is one of the reasons we sent out the financials the last week of the year. Since we have adopted this as a KPI, we historically have not reported this at the conjunction with the window of the CEO's evaluation. We do this with the audited CAFR, and that's usually in the spring. So you end up looking at your financials but not having that complete information point. I think it's appropriate to recommend either we push the financials back out for one more evaluation and look at that, or we can look at a different window. But just looking for a closed out audited CAFR, we don't have that statement. We did dip into reserves last year. We've been talking about the healthcare expenditures. We're ahead of that. We also were hit with liability. You will hear a lot of conversations this year on zero-based budgeting, overhauling our business model, so this does not continue to go forward. But since this has been adopted as a measure, I believe in 12 and 13 we added into reserves, in 14, 15, and 16 we have not. And staff is working on some other presentations for the Finance Committee this year and also our budget to identify what have been our cost drivers moving forward.
Okay. Given the late date, I think I would be supportive of the ad hoc and just bringing it back the next, so we have some time to kind of delve into it.
Okay. Mr. Chairman, one other thing to keep in mind, what we've historically done when it has been delayed, whatever raise is passed is made retroactive to the date it would have otherwise been effective, so there's no net loss revenue to the CEO in that regard.
So there's two parts to this, right? There's the what's in the contract, the 1% and the 3.5%. Based on that, I could be supportive of that today, but if we wanted to consider anything above and beyond that, I would feel more comfortable after we've had a chance to have the complete picture of the KPIs. I know the financials gave me some heartburn, and I was going to bring it up under new business, but I would like to get a report. I mean, we overspent, if I'm reading it correctly, $4.7 million over our budget. Mm-hmm. We dipped into reserves, so I would like to flesh that out a little bit and would recommend that we have a report from our CFO on our year-end financials at our next meeting. But I'd like to hear other comments.
Yes, Mr. Chair. I really think, I mean, it's clear, it was in our book, what everybody evaluated her on. I think we can move forward today with a recommendation on the increase. I know at the county, the average increase was 3.5%, and I think that would be appropriate here, if there's a desire to go higher, yes, it does affect our finances, but I think it's very clear how we view her leadership. She is exemplary in all categories. She does an excellent job. She's thinking out of the box. I could sit here for 10 minutes and talk about just like the presentations and talk about, you know, all the great things that she's done. But I think we can move forward today and make a decision about the performance increase that we're going to give her. So at least we can get that behind us. And it is a motion to approve a 3.5% increase. Performance increase for Ms. Egan.
Before you do that, let's get a clarification from the attorney. Go ahead.
I was going to indicate the contract we're referring to ties that ability to the raise given to the non-bargaining. And the non-bargaining employees, as I understand it, got a 1.5% salary increase and up to a 3.5% bonus increase. So the total would be 5%. If your motion is to be 3.5% total, that you can do that, but I want to know how it would be allocated. I assume no more than 1.5% at salary and the other 2% at bonus, if that's your intent.
Okay, so what did we do last year?
Last year we gave her the same increase that the non-bargaining employees
got. I will rescind my motion and make another motion to give what we have given this year to the non-bargaining employees.
Commissioner Merman?
There's a motion and a second.
Okay.
Motion by Commissioner Merman, second by Mr. Wallace. Morris, I'm sorry. Now, what was the salary increase for Marley?
1.5% and bonus 3.5%.
I want to make it clear. Okay.
Yes. Ms. Egan? Yes, sir. I wanted to clarify. Last year was a 2% base increase and 1% lump sum across the organization, which was what I received. This year we introduced pay for performance. Employees who met expectations received a 1.5% adjustment to base. Those who exceeded or were role models were eligible for an additional 3.5%. to be paid out as a lump sum or as an adjustment to salary. So that's what we had for non-bargaining this year.
You've definitely met all those criteria of exceeding in both areas.
So we have a motion by Commissioner Merman, second by Mr. Wallace.
Can I just ask one clarifying question,
yes.
Chairman? What percentage of the employees got 3.5%?
Do we have that, Jeff? Do we know on 1.5% or versus 3.5%? Do we know our breakdown? I believe it was about 40% were at the 1.5%, 40% were 3.5%, and five employees agency-wide received the total of the 5%.
So any other discussion on the motion? We have a motion by Commissioner Merman, second by Mr. Bowers, to have a salary increase to our executive director of 1.5% salary increase and 3.5% bonus increase.
One other question. I'm sorry. This is because I think the vice chairman's point is very important in terms of the financial. So a lump sum is very different than a base increase on the salary because it goes to the bonus. The 3.5% goes to
the bonus.
Is a lump sum bonus just a one time, or does it go to increase your base at 3.5? So next year you started a 5% increase on your base.
We extended to bargaining. We extended to non-bargaining the option. My recommendation for my particular situation would be a 1.5% adjustment to base, and then the remainder, the 3.5%, be a lump.
Okay.
Any further questions?
I'm sorry. Just one question. Was the one? Mr. Chair, the 1.5%, was that just across the board?
And no, sir, it was toggled to meeting expectations. We did have employees who were related below that who did not receive the 1.5%.
But any above?
Yes, sir. Anyone who was exceeding received up to a 3.5% total of base and lump. And for our rock stars role models, there were five employees who received up to a total of 5%.
Okay. Yeah, I just wanted to acknowledge that there was a range there, not just an across the board. And I think that I would like to see if there's a discussion, given Catherine's performance. I know how I evaluated her, but I just like to see it. Do we want to revisit the 1.5%? If that is you said that was kind of the base. Can you characterize the description again?
And help me understand the motion. I believe the motion is a 1.5% to base and then a 3.5% option for a bonus, which is commensurate to the high performers for non-bargaining.
Right.
So it would be a 1.5% adjustment to my base salary, and the rest would be a lump sum payout.
Right. So I wanted to bring up the potential discussion item, revisiting the 1.5%, given your performance. If there are any thoughts on the board to even consider that in the higher direction, I guess, at a higher percentage. Given other staff, you said that were rock stars.
This matches up to what was offered to our non-bargaining staff.
Non-bargaining.
This is appropriate.
It's appropriate. Okay.
Yes,
this
okay.
is the rock star.
I just wanted to make sure we were giving you
the public sector rock stars, right?
Okay.
Not private
okay.
sector rock stars.
Okay.
Is there any further discussion? Going once, going twice. We have a motion on the floor by Commissioner Merman, second by Mr. Bowers. See no further discussion at this time. All those in favor of the motion, let me know by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposes likewise. Motion is adopted. We would like to address the contract. The contract that she has expires in April of 2016.
May of 2017.
Pardon me?
May of 2017.
May of 2017. We've got time.
My mother will not
May of 17?
No, yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, thank goodness.
I know sitting in that chair sometimes time stands still.
Especially. We need to let the chair December. That's what we need to do. Is there a discussion today on the current contract?
Sir, if I may recommend an ad hoc committee for that.
Yeah. Right. And Chair, I'd like to be on that ad hoc committee.
So why don't we do that today? We probably need about three people to serve on our ad hoc committee. I always meet odd numbers. So we have Councilman Suarez, anyone else?
Oh,
Mr. McClain, and I think I saw... Commissioner Kemp.
No, it's
Kemp. Okay, that's it. Councilman Suarez, Mr. McClain, and Commissioner Kemp, and I'll let you all get together and decide who will be chair. Any objections to that?
No.
No objection. Okay. I still think we need to let the chair in December, let him come in and be with us. Anything else, Mr. Smith?
No, sir.
Okay. The committees, we don't have to do anything the committees do.
Okay. No, sir.
Right. We're now in the public comment. Anyone wishing to address this body, you have 3 minutes, please come forward. Everyone signed up. Is there any old business? Any new business?
Yeah, if I could, I was going to bring this up in new business, but I kind of brought it up in the CEO evaluation. As part of a presentation from finance, another thing that was concerning to me from the financial statement was we had a fund balance, and correct me if I'm wrong, but only it looked like $600,000 at the end of August. Is that our entire cash reserves at that point in time?
As I'm sure Jeff is working his way up here. Yes, ma'am. Last year, so we receive about $10 million annually from the feds, and they track later and later on reimbursement. And last year we had a convergence of a perfect storm of very late reimbursement from the feds and a few other factors.
Good morning. Jeff Sirigi, Financial Officer. Excuse me. Yes, you read correctly. There was a time last summer that we had $686,000 in the bank, and that was it. The reason, the perfect storm, the federal government, we're awaiting over $10 million of reimbursements from the federal government for our federal formula. Last year, the federal government chose to shut their system down and initiate a new system. There was a specific deadline to be able to get documentation in prior to the closing of that. Some of our documentation did not get in on time due to personnel issues on our side. However, the federal government didn't work with us during the entire process. So did our vendors. And we received in a very timely manner our full reimbursement from the federal government. And we have put measures in place and controls in place to ensure the consistent monitoring of our cash flow over the next year is paramount, and building controls that situation won't occur again.
Okay. Because I thought, and I'm glad to know that, and I totally get it, those things happen. However, I thought we had a board policy where we had 3 months of operating expenses in the bank. And if you look at our current operating expenses of $72 million, that's $6 million a month. So we should, am I wrong that we should have roughly at any time around $15 to $20 million in our cash reserves?
The way the policy works is that it gets booked at year-end. So whatever fund balance we have at the total of year-end, we should have 3 months operating in the reserve during that period of time at the end of October 31st, or September 31st. In FY16, which I will report back to you, we did not meet that requirement due to an over-expenditure of between healthcare and under-collection of some of our revenues. So I will be prepared to present an entire state of our finances in the next one.
Okay. Yeah, that was, it just leapt out. I'm doing the evaluation. I'm looking at these financials, and that just leapt out at me. And I think, you know, I as a board member would like to hear these things as they happen, as they get close, just so we can be aware of it. And I was caught off guard, and that's the reason why I bring it up. I would like maybe in the future when we get to that point. I mean, if there's a point where we can't meet payroll, I think we need to be aware of that. And I don't know that that's the case. And please, don't characterize. I shouldn't have said that because it just was concerning. It was concerning, and I think that we need to report on that a little bit more regularly.
I agree with that.
Yeah. So, Mr. White, you recognize.
So our year-end fund balance is published in a CAFR each year, correct?
Correct.
Okay. If you haven't already planned to do so, and if the board agrees, if we have consensus, I'd like to see the published year-end fund balance from the past, say, five CAFRs as part of that report.
Absolutely.
And Commissioner White, to your request, one of the issues we have been looking at for this year is coming in and meeting a little more often, but probably shorter time frames with our finance committee. We say transit is changing, but part of what's changing for us is just doing business as a public entity. So we are seeing declining ridership. We're also seeing our healthcare expense in certain other areas going up. It's not sustainable. And we are fortunate that this is happening in a good economy, because if this were happening and our ad valorem was contracting, we'd be having much different conversations. So this is one of the driving reasons we're doing a zero-based budget this year. If I am fortunate enough for the board to extend my contract, knocking on whatever this is, this would be the first time since 2004 you've had a CEO for more than 3 years. So really what that's meant for us strategically and budget-wise is a lot of scar tissue and bondo. This is a good opportunity for us to clear out what our expectations are, what we need to be meeting, what are some things that are always a few years out, what are some cost drivers. So what we bring to you is a budget that is sustainable, dropping money into the bank, service can grow, and we are ahead of these trends. In looking at our fund balance, we have not been able to negotiate that, and this is the year where we, I don't want to say plant the flag, that sounds like we're a, is that a football reference? I don't know anything about football. Someone give me a good football reference. But this is a year where we're turning around how we do business, because it's clearly not sustainable to go forward down this path.
Yes, I'm sure.
Yeah, and I just want to be clear that in my evaluation under financial, I said that a lot of these abilities, I'm not blaming the agency, and I think Catherine's done a stellar job mitigating the costs because we have been looking at the healthcare costs the whole past year. We have done the taxi vouchers where we're cutting our paratransit costs down in half. But there are some things beyond control. Ridership, you know, we saw a 5.8% ridership decline. We were $2 million under in our fare collection. I'm looking at today's packet, and I'm seeing that trend even going worse. So we've got to address this. I think it's very important. And, you know, some of the initiatives is new business. I really think we need to look at our paratransit costs. I think when we did the pilot for the taxi voucher, it started in January of last year, and we did talk about having maybe a, you know, after we get enough data, let's compare the two. Maybe we need to increase our share into the taxi voucher because it's basically cut our costs in half. You know, maybe we need to look as an agency of going harder and
more incentives
and,
for that
and going into that direction.
And so, we have we've expanded beyond with DOT funding running out on the grant. We have expanded that.
Right.
We are continuing to offer because people love the convenience, but we love the cost. And I will say briefly, many of these things may be out of our control. It's still our responsibility to deliver a balanced budget for the county. You know, and at the end of the day, a patron should be able to move to a good school district and take a job across county if they can take transit and not have to choose in a few years between pulling their kid out of school or losing their vesting toward retirement. That's what we're here for. So we appreciate the understanding that staff has done yeoman's work, but it is still our job to bring it in balance and make sure that we can be here year after year.
And you're doing that through a bunch of these innovations, and that's why, to me, I'm looking at the innovations that, you know, that's how I weighted, you know, my decision a little bit differently maybe than perhaps other board members when we were looking at the federal lobbyists. But I do think, you know, innovation, in not only in the way we fund things, but in the technology, you know, rideshare, autonomous vehicles, those things are coming down quickly, and I know we are leading that. So, anyhow, I appreciate all the work that you've done, but I did want to bring that to the board's attention.
Okay. So any other new business? Seeing none, is there any other board comments? Seeing none, we're adjourned.
No, not really.